WCBN. At the University of Michigan.
You are listening live to WCBN Sports coverage of the Frozen Four semifinal between Boston College and Michigan. It's been nearly 10 years since these two teams last met on the ice, but it won't be the first time that they've met on the biggest stage. Each of these programs are trying to reestablish their championship pedigree, though. The Eagles trying to get back to where they were as the premier program of the early 2000s, winning four titles from 2001 to 2012. They'll make their first appearance in the Frozen Four since 2016. The Wolverines, on the other hand, have done anything and everything they can this century that a Tiffany program would do, except win the national title. They haven't won one since 1998. They hope to finally break through to their championship game on this, their third straight go-around in the Frozen Four semifinal. Losing to Denver in 2022 could potentially rematch that team with a win after their win against Boston University and Quinnipiac last season in Tampa. I welcome in my broadcast partners for tonight's proceedings, Owen Crain and Kendall Spencer. How we doing? This is a great atmosphere here in St. Paul.
Oh, William, we are good. I can't speak for Kendall, but the energy in this arena, the 10-hour drive up to St. Paul, it all comes together as we look towards the third straight Frozen Four appearance for Michigan.
This is a team that, you know, has been special for a long enough time that you start to wonder what special means anymore, but this year is no exception. They just keep getting better. It feels like it shouldn't be possible this late in the year, but these Wolverines are playing their best hockey right now, and I'm excited to see what they throw out here tonight.
We're about 30 seconds away from puck drop. It was delayed about an hour because of the overtime period in the BU-Denver game. That one won 2-1 on a game-winning shot for Denver by Tristan Brose about 11 minutes into the overtime period. That sends Denver to the national championship game, which these two teams are working to get to. Michigan trying to get to the national title game for the first time in this trifecta of Frozen Four appearances over the past three seasons and look for their 10th national title. BC trying to get back to where they were in 2012 when they last won the national title. Frank Nasr and Cutter Gauthier. Gauthier, one of the three Hobie Baker finalists. That award will be announced tomorrow. Leads the country in goals with 37. Will face off at center ice. And the 2024 men's Frozen Four semifinal is underway. Boston College and the University of Michigan. The Wolverines win it, and Marshall Warren dumps it deep. Gavin Brindley for the Wolverines trying to recover in the corner. Passes along to Nasr behind the net. Nasr knocked down by Drew Fortescue, the freshman D-man. Puck works its way into the slot. A shot from McGroarty, softly blocked by Cutter Gauthier. Stays in the zone for Michigan. Brindley sends it around the boards. Left side, Nasr. It's picked up by the Eagles. Fortescue to Eamon Powell, the BC captain. Up ice, across center. A pass for Andre Gasso gets away. And it's an icing across two zones. 19:25 to go in the first period. Michigan, a little bit of offensive possession to start.
Well, McGroarty had an opportunity in front. He hesitated on the shot, though, and then finally decided to go for it. The defender was in the way of his shot, and it ultimately ricocheted. I say take that shot the first time, don't hesitate, and you've got a better chance.
Faceoff comes back down into the BC zone. TJ Hughes against Gauthier, who stays out there on the ice, second line appearing for Michigan. Casey coming back from injury. His shot goes wide left off the pass from Hughes. Missed that game against Michigan State. In front of the net, Hughes, low slot, his shot goes wide again, BC out and running. Dumped deep by Eamon Powell for a change after they couldn't get off after the icing.
Great start for the Wolverines offensively. They're getting wide open looks. BC's going to need to tighten up on defense.
Shifsky to Dylan Duke, back to Seamus Casey, keeps it in the zone. Casey, another shot goes wide right out in front of the net, no! TJ Hughes picks it up in the right corner. Casey, another shot from the blue line, this time deflected wide. And BC trying to dig it out of the zone, being offensively dominated in this first minute and a half. But on the fast break, Ryan Leonard to Will Smith. He shoots and scores! The Eagles on the board first. Michigan owned possession for the first 80 seconds of this game. And the kid line strikes with a vengeance. Ryan Leonard to Will Smith. That's how BC does it. Welcome in the broadcaster cam once again. We're trying to give you guys a heavy dose of this because, you know, the feedback
was
always...
I was kind of slacking on turning it on.
The feedback was always, you know, it's always good with the broadcaster cam. It's fun. You actually get action.
Do you want to raise it up a little bit more? It's...
How do we do it?
No, I like angle it up a tad. Okay. Just a teeny, teeny bit.
We're operating.
There we go.
We've got...
I like that.
Two, like, paper bowls that the camera is sitting on right now to elevate it. Fresh from the
you know what?
Minnesota Wild banquet behind us.
Let's see if we can't get a second angle on the broadcaster cam.
Oh, we've gone mad with power now.
I think
we, you know, once we figure this out, we should talk about the Hobie Baker Award. They're showing the three nominees, Jackson Blake, Macklin Celebrini, and Cutter Gauthier, up on the Jumbotron here at Xcel Energy Arena. What are you doing?
He's trying to get a second angle.
Hey,
it's just you.
It's just me.
He was talking about how he wanted to show off.
Yeah.
So there's our broadcaster.
That's our
cam.
Setup.
Can you show him? I don't know if we can risk how high up we are.
Uh-oh.
Nothing but.
We've lost connection.
Nothing.
Oh, we're back.
There's Kendall. Hi, Kendall.
Show him the.
And here's our angle of the ice.
Yeah.
Nothing but MacGyver engineering over here at WCBN Sports.
You know, we're all kind of soft. What do you call them? Soft majors, I guess. We're not in the hard sciences, but we come up when we need to
hard,
come up
I'm
with
a
something.
Political scientist.
What oh, do you mean? Yeah. Okay.
Anyways.
Spending all that out-of-state tuition on the Ford School. Talk about the Hobie.
Hobie Baker. Hobie Baker. Oh, it's my graphic. Okay, I'll talk about it. Yeah. The Hobie Hat Trick is the name they give the three finalists for the Hobie Baker Award. This year, it's not a Michigan player. In fact, a Michigan player is not a finalist. Finalists, like mentioned, Jackson Blake, Macklin Celebrini, Cutter Gauthier. All great players, all, you know, worthy nominees. But we'd also like to give a shout out to Gavin Brindley, who was snubbed from, you know, even a nomination for this award. When he has been, like, the lifeblood of this team all season, he kind of went under the radar a little bit just because he got drafted to the same team as Adam Fantilli, who obviously soaked up the spotlight, deserved, last year. But he's really stepped up this year to become kind of the face of this team. And, you know, wanted to give him a shout-out despite the Hobie Baker Award. Yeah. Not. And also, look up Hobie Baker. Him and Niall Kinnick led the same life.
Yeah, crazy. Dying in training flights.
Training flights,
in
yeah.
World Wars.
Crazy.
In, like, weird spots. Brindley, Big Ten Player of the Year. It's crazy that he wasn't even in the top ten to me.
Yeah.
As essential as he is to this team. And, I mean, I think you could have gone with Brindley, McGroarty, or Casey. But Brindley is, the guy on offense for Michigan. And since the defense isn't exactly spectacular, you might not put Casey... his plus-minus is not great as far as defensemen go. Plus 6 on the ice this season compared to someone like Ethan Edwards at plus 14 or even Fantilli at plus 13 with the limited time he gets. Seamus Casey, kind of a pure offensive defenseman. Just inside of 10 minutes to go in this first intermission. It was an excited first period. Goal coming really quick for BC from Will Smith, who's more of an assist guy, but certainly can put it in the net. I think we've talked a lot about hockey. We should talk about the food we got.
Oh my God!
Tonight,
I knew we would mention this at some point. I didn't expect it to be 5 minutes
into the first intermission. David Kraemer just texted me. David Kraemer, my color commentary partner last season against Quinnipiac in the Frozen Four in Tampa. They served us salmon.
Love salmon.
Great food. I mean, the food was fine tonight. Maybe not meeting our expectation, especially we all three of us went to Minnesota for the football game this October. The University of Minnesota provided us with mac and cheese, pulled pork, really heavy stuff. Yeah, a little, you know, cinnamon whiskey bread pudding.
Not great.
I think the word we've been using is mid.
Meh.
Yeah, we've been talking about being less critical on broadcast.
I have never said that.
Food was fine, but earlier today we had some great paninis. Where were we?
Fort Douglas?
Camp Douglas.
Camp Douglas.
Camp Douglas, Wisconsin. No, we've been to Culver's a million times. I love Culver's. But this place, two nickel deli, right?
Yes.
Or double?
Exit 55.
Double nickel deli, something like that.
At exit 55.
It was advertised to us relentlessly, and I'm like, you know what?
William's a sucker for
Double nickel deli.
Double nickel deli. We had these great paninis. I had the ham and cheese. Owen had the crepe. What did you have, Kendall? I'd never heard of what you had.
Muffaletta. It's
like a New Orleans thing.
Yeah, I'm annoying.
I had the banana cream cake. That was great. And then also the thing about Camp Douglas is it's called Camp Douglas because it's at a Wisconsin Air National Guard airfield called Volk Field. So when we got there before the lunch rush, it was empty at like 11:30. Mm-hmm. When we got in afterwards, you know, probably upwards of 10 servicemen and women came in and ordered their lunch. And you have to figure whenever, you know, police officers or firefighters or military are coming in to a spot like that, you know, it's good. And it was good.
I was pleased with it.
Yeah. We saw some fighters dancing in the sky.
And not only the fighter jets, but the other backdrop was these sandstone formations, I think part of the Wisconsin Dells, like huge kind of columns of sandstone. And the restaurant itself was inside a BP, like right off the highway.
Sign.
So I don't know what else you would want from a road trip experience. It's not like the middle of Wisconsin is the most resplendent with points to it.
The Uber was pulling up the street.
Yeah, and we were like, cancel it. We got in the door. And we're going to go back after a nice little touristy trip around St. Paul. Telling you this now because this is, you know, could be the only game with Michigan.
This is first intermission stuff.
We will be back on air for the national championship no matter who plays in that game, whether that be BC Denver or Michigan and Denver. We hope it's Michigan and Denver, obviously. And you Michigan fans out there hope it as well. And we mentioned a few times that this building is no stranger to hosting Frozen Fours. Michigan, no stranger to this building, especially playing BC in 07. Since 2002, they played in every Frozen Four hosted at Xcel Energy Arena in St. Paul, Minnesota. It's kind of a streak that they're on, making this fourth Frozen Four. They were here in 2002. They were here. I've got to see it. Where is it? I think it was 2007.
It is 2011.
And 2018?
Yes.
And 2024. Gotta get those dates right. The sites rotate every year.
Those are correct.
But Michigan to the past four, only in 2011 did they make the national title game.
I want everyone to know that how hard it was to make this graphic, to find a team photo from like
each
the
season.
Regional in 2002. They don't exist.
And especially you see that it's not a PNG graphic. It's got a white border.
I tried to make it a PNG and you couldn't read it.
Well, it's got the trees.
Can we quickly acknowledge how much better the 2002 logo for the Frozen Four is than any of these other?
Well, you mean 2011?
No.
I like the 2002 one.
Oh, I like the two. Yeah.
The quality's just not good.
But back when they allowed creative
and
logos.
And photos don't exist. 2000, like, even 2007, trying to find photos of this team, impossible.
The NCAA.
Thank God for the age we live in now.
Kind of a embargo against creativity. The last few Frozen Four logos, not creative at all, even though the Final Four in men's basketball and women's basketball have been really good. Michigan off the faceoff. TJ Hughes is tripped. And a penalty on Boston College. As Michigan was trying to control in the BC zone, another power play for the Wolverines, 8:15 to go in the second period.
That's also a place where the Eagles have gotten a little sloppy, just throwing their sticks around. I mean, that was the most obvious trip.
And it's Fortescue, another
in
freshman.
The world.
Fortescue, another freshman for Boston College going to the box. Michigan's third power play of the game. And he tripped him so bad he lost his own stick because Hughes fell on it. 5-on-4 hockey from inside the BC zone. It's Posma, the assistant captain, fourth line center against TJ Hughes. Hughes losing the faceoff to BC. Minedian controls, trying to clear, and gets it out of the zone. Brindley trying to keep it in, couldn't get his stick to it. Early clear for Boston College. Both teams 0 for 2 on the power play, both BC and Michigan. Nearly a turnover. A backwards pass from Casey gets batted around. It's kept by Gavin Brindley. Brindley now along the point. Keeps it in the zone to Hughes. And a trip called. Not sure who it's on yet.
That looks like Duke.
Yeah, it's
going to
be Michigan.
Duke.
Dylan Duke in the box for tripping. We'll see where it came from. Yeah, it was when Brindley was controlling at the blue line. Duke tips an eagle, or excuse me, trips an eagle. I couldn't see who it was. Get a better replay. It's Jack Malone who was tripped in an attempt to block the Brindley pass from just inside the zone. So another period of 4-on-4 hockey for the next 26 seconds.
And that's a tough look for Michigan. An elite power play stifled.
They're blocking their blessings.
I like that.
Perreault off the faceoff for BC. Now Will Smith.
I got that from an SNL skit.
Smith skating inside himself. Smith along the left side. His shot is blocked. Wraparound try is in. Will Smith, second of the game. 2-0 Boston College.
That shouldn't have happened.
Yeah, and I want to see the replay on this because I'm not certain it was as much a wraparound as it was. He bumped it into the crease and it somehow ricocheted in.
I mean, from our vantage point,
we'll take
to me
look.
It looked like a wraparound. Yeah. No, he just passed it in, and it looked like it was off Perreault maybe, and also Pletsky in there for Michigan. I think it went off Perreault's skate, if anything.
Of course, not a kicking motion, so it's a clean goal. That might not have...
It went from Perreault to Pletsky and then in. So they'll give the goal to Perreault and the assist to Will Smith.
Just sloppy.
And just like that, oh... Wolverine power play turns into 4-on-4, turns into another BC goal.
And the 4-on-4 is still ongoing for the next minute. And since it was 4-on-4, BC did not score with the advantage. They keep their power play, and they will have another 30 seconds after the Michigan penalty expires. A shot is blocked out in front of the net by Boston College as Michigan enters the zone. Sloppy pass from Herchuk is picked off by the Wolverines. High slot pass from Tyler Duke to Casey. Goes nowhere as Casey's pass into the crease is tipped. And eventually McGroarty being tripped by Gauthier after Gauthier pokes away the puck. Gauthier inside and scores. 3-0 just like that. Boston College with 6:46 to go in the second period opens the floodgates.
Very tired Casey was on the chase but could not catch up.
Yeah, that's kind of what you were worried about at the beginning of the game when something happens that fast. Here it's almost a comedy of errors. I mean, knocking the puck in off your own defender, knocking the puck in, a trip leading to a breakaway goal. I mean, it's just, anything that can go wrong has gone wrong with the past minute for the Wolverines. And in spite of it all, BC will still have 30 seconds of a power play.
Yeah, and both goals have been scored on the 4-on-4. You're right, Kendall, and we mentioned earlier, in the earlier 4-on-4, both these teams like playing with speed, BC enjoying it a little bit more. We got another graphic to show you. We're showing the MVP graphic, I guess, first. Who's your MVP? Drop it in the chat. We got three Boston College players. Jacob Fowler, who is currently pitching a shutout. Will Smith, who was credited for that second goal. It wasn't Perreault. So Will Smith has two goals tonight. And Cutter Gauthier, who made it 3-0, poking the puck away from McGroarty, taking it himself for his nation-leading and potential NHL or NCAA record 38th goal of the season.
Shutout, 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 shutout. If I say it enough, it'll jinx it, right?
And then for Michigan, it's a question mark.
Because someone needs to be.
Because someone needs to step up, but we don't know who that is yet. So you can vote. Basically, the vote for the question mark is a vote for Michigan to win this game. And a vote for any of the BC players is a vote for any of the BC players. We'll check the chat, you know, throughout the game.
I think each of the three BC players we've listed have a case to be made.
That's not Cutter Gauthier on the left side. You put Fowler's face twice. It was a scramble.
Who screwed that up as he made the graphic in real time? No one knows.
Yeah, we made this graphic in the second period, intermission.
Jacob Fowler's just so good.
We had it templated, and we just had to plug it in. But, yeah, we got two Jacob Fowlers.
We had a template that we only needed to plug in, and yet somehow the template got screwed up.
No tie for any of us today. I mean, I've eschewed the necktie since our trip to Lake Superior State. We both wore ties for that game in the Sioux.
I've gotten rid of the necktie then, since my neck got a little fatter and it started rubbing up, giving me a rash.
Dynamite drop in, Owen. I'm glad that you're spending your out-of-state tuition dollars at the University of Michigan to say stuff like that on WCBN Sports.
Well, you know what I wanted? I thought that we should have had an OJ segment today, and I quickly shot down.
It would have been tasteful.
Very. It would have been timely, appropriate.
I don't want to make light of the tragedy, but, well, two tragedies. One happened like 30 years ago.
Yeah. Right.
But, you know, I don't. You put me in a bad spot here. What'd you do that for?
You didn't need to respond to that.
You didn't need to bring it up.
I watched The Naked Gun the other day.
The Naked Gun's so funny.
That's really good. I like that movie.
And OJ just, you know, gets the crap beat out of him. So if you want to watch an entertaining movie and are not an OJ fan, watch The Naked Gun. And if you are an OJ fan, he's in a movie. And I don't know.
I watched that for the first time during COVID.
Nothing to see here.
They played on like MLB Network because they have nothing else to play. And they're
They end with Reggie Jackson trying to shoot.
He is not credited, by the way, as himself.
And he walks like a robot. That's always funny.
They didn't give him a name. He is just like outfielder.
Yeah. Brutal. Leslie Nielsen, one of my comedy heroes. I love him. I am not 1 ounce as funny as he is.
You're 1 ounce.
No,
don't say yourself that.
Short. He was not only a leading man, but also one of the funniest people to ever walk the earth. And I think his career was one of the best. Starting off as a dramatic actor, not cutting it, and then being in The Naked Gun, well, being an airplane with gray hair at like 50 plus, starring in his first box office hit, and then parlaying another 30-year career after that. But
this is a broadcast full of wannabe film buffs.
Yeah, enough about Leslie Nielsen, as much as I love him. 40 seconds to go in the second period of intermission. Food in the first intermission. Leslie Nielsen, airplane in the second intermission. Hockey for the third period. Michigan down 3-0 to the Boston College Eagles. One thing quick from you guys. How do they get back in this game, the Wolverines?
Same exact thing I've said like 12 times today, William. Possession. And in the end to these needless neutral zone turnovers, if the Wolverines can control the puck and move it well, create space for themselves on offense, and especially drive towards the crease, they could start to cut away at this deficit.
Take better shots, get in close, and let the shooter shoot.
Shoot your shot, Michigan.
That too, I guess.
Here we go. 20 minutes potentially left in this season. The 101st season of Michigan hockey. Brindley out there to take the faceoff. Wins it for the Wolverines. Edwards plays a pass to McGroarty over his stick into the BC zone. Recovered by Minetti and for the Eagles. Gasso puts a nice check. Duke tries a wraparound from behind the net. Still out in front. Battling for it, McGroarty. And Rutger eventually coming away with it. Back up top to the blue line, Edwards. McGroarty putting the pressure on. From the left wing, a shot is deflected wide. Duke battling for the rebound. McGroarty comes away with it.
Gorgeous forecheck.
Pass to Warren. Skating along the point. Along the boards. Another wraparound try for Dylan Duke is deflected by Fowler. Warren can't keep it in the zone against BC. And it comes to Ethan Edwards, skating up from his own zone. Across center ice, Edward makes a nice move to get by a few Eagle defenders. To the left wing, Shifsky. Shifsky behind the boards to Hughes. Back up top, intercepted in the slot by Perreault. Gabe Perreault not credited for the second BC goal of the game. That goes to Will Smith, his second.
William, I think we're seeing Michigan start off the period with a lot more energy and speed than they did the second. A necessary adjustment if they want to close this deficit.
Here's a turnover. Ryan Leonard all by himself against Barcheski, making another sprawling save off his left leg protector. Michigan stays within three.
Hopefully that can be a catalyst for the Wolverines, knowing that their goaltender standing strong behind them.
Hughes inside on the right wing. Casey there as well. Hughes gets it back along the boards, tries a centering pass that goes out of the zone. 18:08 to go in the third period. Michigan controlling for almost the entirety of this period so far. Now BC trying to clear their zone. Picked off by Ernesty on the right side. Pass to Nasr on the left side. Nasr leaves one for Ernesty in the slot, but they cannot connect. Back down, controlled by Truscott. Pass up to Estapa is deflected, but makes its way to the native of St. Clair, Michigan, to Holtz. Slaps one along the boards. Redirected back to Holtz. On the right side, his shot from the blue line is deflected by Fowler. Nearly went in. Wasn't exactly a hard one from the blue line, but a chance for Michigan. They still control. Entering the zone once again. Nasr has it poked away in another fast break opportunity for BC. Here comes Ambrosio, right side pass to Posma. Goes over his stick and off the rebound, Michigan on the fast break. Here comes Shifsky, leaves one to LaPointe, and LaPointe overskated. Cannot pick up that puck and put a shot on net. Here's Posma. Posma to Joyce. Joyce skates on net, puts a shot wide around the boards. Redirected the other way, LaPointe. Up to Pletsky. Fourth line for Michigan, getting ice time here in the third period, needing three goals, the Wolverines. 16:45 to go in the third. Looked like Connor Joyce just tripped a referee on the right side. Now Casey comes up that same direction. Casey, nice move in the right faceoff circle. His shot gets deflected, though. Tyler Duke comes away with it for Michigan off the rebound. 16:30 to go. Brindley skating on the left side, pass to McGordy. His shot is deflected, and it seems like every time Michigan passes back to a good shot on the wing, BC there with a stick or a leg to deflect it.
BC has done a great job locking down the house, that area surrounding the crease in between the hash marks of the two circles. And I have two thoughts on Michigan's aggressiveness. One, it's great. They're finally getting shots off and moving the puck well. But in pursuit of these offensive opportunities, they're making defensive mistakes. We already saw a breakaway with Barczewski, spreading eagle, standing on his head, and then a two-on-one fast break. So the Wolverines, as much as they need offense, they need to ensure the Eagles can't score another.
Off the faceoff in the BC zone, it's initially won by the Eagles, but Michigan able to retain possession of the puck and enter the zone. From behind the net, it's Tyler Duke, forced into the corner by two Eagles. Shoots a pass up where Shifsky was in the area for, but Fortescue controls for Boston College. Turned over in the Michigan zone. Casey, off his knee, controls across center ice. Casey by himself. Casey up the left side. Casey drops a pass for Hughes. Can't put a shot on. Nice look for Michigan. 20 shots for the Maize and Blue. No goals. 15:36 to go. They need an answer. Down 3-0 in the Frozen Four semifinal to avoid a third straight opening round defeat. Luca Fantilli putting a shot on net. It's blocked out in front. Boston College looking to clear. Perreault into the corner, picked up by Duke. Duke tries a pass into the slot. Brindley wasn't in position to shoot it, but receives the pass. Sends one along the boards, picked up by Duke, forced into the corner to Truscott. Truscott turns it over to Boston College. Will Smith. Cross-ice pass off the boards to Leonard. If he controlled it, he had some ice. Fantilli, though, turns it over once again. Perreault skating inside, one-on-three. Perreault tries a wraparound, and he scores.
Kind of a befuddling decision there by Barczewski. I know that when there's a player on that side, you're supposed to cling to your crease, but he was extremely slow in getting over. Perreault had the net wide open.
And it looked, Barczewski had come out of the net, so he wasn't just clinging. He came out of his crease just enough that he couldn't use the far post to redirect himself back to the other side. It was too slow, and that's too easy for Gabe Perreault, who makes it 4-0 Boston College with 14:57 to go in the third period. And after 30 minutes of hockey of 1-0 play, it's now 4-0 after only 15 minutes. Three goals for Boston College in that time on only 16 shots. Leonard drops one to Posma, intercepted by TJ Hughes. 26 seconds to go in the season. 4-0 BC, a drubbing. First time Michigan will be shut out barring a last second goal since November of 22. In State College against the Nittany Lions. The crowd, the remaining crowd, is on their feet. Michigan, for the third straight season, is going to lose in the opening game of the Frozen Four. Boston College advances. They will face Denver Saturday night for the national championship. And for these Wolverines, this run comes to an end. The team will look a lot different next season. And these guys left it all out on the ice tonight, but Boston College showed why they're the number one team in the country and showed why Michigan came into this game ranked 10th before the polls changed when they made the Frozen Four.
And as we reflect on this game, I don't think there will be any specific thing that cost Michigan the game tonight. It wasn't Barcheski in net, as the offense was unable to score a single goal. It wasn't the Wolverine defense giving up tough opportunities. All around, the Wolverines were unable to put together a complete game, unable to generate offense. And they played an honorable game, but could not compete with the Boston College Eagles.
Kendall, anything to say? I think we're going to sign off pretty quick and try and...
Womp womp.
Show the graphic. That's what the national championship game is. That's the graphic we put up. That's the city of St. Paul. Reused. Me and David Kraemer pioneered that one for the games in Tampa last season. Same kind of result, though. BC moves on. DU moves on, and they'll face each other in the national championship game. BC trying to get their first title since 2012. Denver trying to win the record 10th. I don't know, if you guys don't have anything else to say, I want to get down and see this press conference. I saw it last season. It was very moving to see a team play their final game, and I just want to say a word. This, you know, what else do you guys have to say?
Well, I think as disheartening and sad to watch, but overall it's been a pleasure and honor and excellent opportunity to follow this Michigan team and call so many of their games this season.
Nobody thought they would go this far.
I didn't.
They really stepped up, and at the end of the day, they beat Sparty, and that's all that matters. Yeah.
And finish 2-4 instead of 1-5. I just want to say I was feeling pretty strong. I don't know how I'm going to last through this little bit that I'm going to talk here. We're going to be back Saturday night to call a national championship game, BC and Denver. But for me, as a graduating senior, this is the final game of Michigan Athletics that I'm going to call for WCBN. And I have not been more blessed in my life than to have gotten the opportunity to do what I've done for WCBN Sports. Going all across the country in my college career, going to California, going to Texas, witnessing the Michigan football team win the national championship. All those fun games, trips with Owen, trips with Kendall. We were here in October. And beyond that, the friends that I've made through WCBN Sports, lifelong friends, you guys, wouldn't have met you otherwise. The first time we met each other at that Buffalo Wild Wings Monday Night Football watch party. Who are these two weird kids from St. Louis and Providence? But now we're here. We're going to enjoy the rest of the weekend together. Obviously, I have to thank Kelin Flynn, my best friend. And we've been in school together since middle school. He told me to come to a meeting and said, they pay for your road trips. And that sold it for me. And I never in my wildest dreams would imagine that I'd be able to call these games and share these opportunities with family and friends. And it has been life-changing. Life-changing is all I can say. And it's sad that it ends like this, but happy to be here. Happy to be with you guys. Anything else we want to say? For the final time, as play-by-play commentator for WCBN Sports of a Michigan sporting event, I will wish you all a good night. Michigan losing 4-0 in the first round of the Frozen Four. I'll wish you a good night, and go Blue.
Hello, welcome back to Ann Arbor, Michigan. This production at WCBN Sports of Michigan Field Hockey. You're tuning in with 2 minutes left to go in the halftime intermission as the Michigan Wolverines lead 1-0 over the Northwestern Wildcats. This matchup between these two top 10 ranked teams in the United States in NCAA play. Adam Bressler here with William Bradley. How's it going today?
Pretty good. I was on for the first goal, and that was pretty exciting. It was a nice shot off the penalty from the short corner. And I'm surprised it's been the only goal today, but the defense for both teams has really, really stepped up so far since that point. Northwestern's only got one shot on goal. Michigan's got four, but they've only been able to convert one.
Michigan retains their possession over time of possession, but they just have not been able to get anything offensively productive in their eight shots on goal.
And we're going to have another icing.
As Minnesota, again, misplays a pass to Cruikshank. And it'll be back for another faceoff. Bordeleau now against Staudaker, it looks. No, it'll be 24. Yes. And we have a goal. Sorry about that. Looking for the name of the Minnesota defender. Michigan scores right off the faceoff. Good thing not many people are listening with the Big Ten title on. My bad, folks. Goal scored by the Wolverines. Ties the game 1-1.
Pull up three, Tyson Walker. Rims away. Rebound Devontae Jones, and he's off and running. Pass to Terrence Williams on the fast break. Williams thought about the three-pointer, but passes away to Dickinson. Jones now. Nice pick by Dickinson inside. Dickinson slams it home, and that might spell doom for the Spartans.
Yeah, honestly, nice cut there by Dickinson. He was wide open for the dunk, and nice pass there by Devontae Jones.
Offense needs to hurry up now for the Spartans. Gabe Brown has it, pulls away. Walker now to Akins. Akins pass inside. Hauser taking long time, 20 seconds off the shot clock, but Joey Hauser makes the face-up jumper over Terrence Williams to pull back within 15.
Yeah, huge shot there by Hauser. Brings it back down to 15 for the Spartans. Still have a fighter's chance at this game.
Houston now left wing, pass inside Dickinson. We've seen it all day on the left block. Dickinson working against Julius Marble. Dickinson inside, overpowers him and dunks it over his head. Foul called. Count it.
Holy, that's probably the most dominant play I've seen by Hunter Dickinson.
Dickinson honestly flexing all over this Chrysler Center crowd. What a dunk.
Huge dunk.
And that might be the dunk that sends Michigan State home without a win. We saw it on a nice feed from Devontae Jones earlier, but this one was all Dickinson working inside, gets away from Marble, slams it home on the reverse, but he clanks away the free throw, misses it on the and-one free throw attempt. Spartans have it. Walker working, pass away, Gabe Brown, left wing, three-pointer off, rebound Joey Hauser. Max Christie flying in, foul is called on Eli Brooks. Bit surprised the foul was called on Brooks there, as Christie was the one coming in fast. Dwayne Stevens talking to Julius Marble. Dwayne Stevens, the assistant coach for Michigan State. Marble receives the pass on the inbounds play. Gets it away to Tyson Walker. Screen set now by Marble. Pull up, mid-range shot. Walker knocks it down. Still not good enough, though. Michigan State remains down 15, 75-60. Five and change left in the second half. Jones has it, not pushing it, slow and methodical, trying to burn this clock. Jones spins away from Walker, trying to get around some screens, gets to the right wing, pass off Houston, dives inside, loses the ball, gets it back. Caleb Houston now inside to Dickinson, but it's stolen by Julius Marble.
Honestly, that was just a freshman's mistake there by Caleb Houston. He was feeling a little pressured there, losing the ball.
Tyson Walker running inside, runs into Hunter Dickinson and is fouled. A bit upset. He did not make the and one there. He had a clear layup opportunity, but he missed the rim. He'll go to the line for two. Walker at the line for his two free throw attempts. Misses the first. And you see the game slipping away, the frustration from Walker after that missed free throw. He'll try for the second. Student section making noise. Couple dribbles for Walker as he sends that free throw home. 75-61, 4:49 remaining. Michigan State putting on the press. Williams inbounds Dickinson across the logo. Maintained by the Wolverines. Jones working on Walker now. And Tyson Walker with a nice on-ball steal out and running his state. Joey Hauser dunks it off the assist from Walker. Quick fast break bucket for the Wolverine, or for the Spartans, excuse me.
That's a way the Spartans can get back into this game is on-ball turnovers. Get those fast break opportunities, get some easy baskets, and you're back in this game.
Crowd looking for a foul on Jones as he sort of pushed off Tyson Walker. No call. Michigan retains. On the right block, Dickinson, nice spin move, and another dunk. Julius Marble cannot guard Hunter Dickinson. Dickinson strutting his stuff across the midcourt logo.
Now I got to ask you, of course, your player of the game today.
Brandon Nye, definitely. I mean, we talked about it. Home run, two hits, two scoreless innings. Great day for the freshman.
Non-Michigan side, you give it to Clark Elliott with the three-run bomb.
Definitely he fits well. Sorry.
It's been I think you were about to sneeze or something.
I have been having a coughing problem.
Oh.
We've got about 3.5 hours calling this game. No water. Gets to again.
I could always share mine with you.
Burton has a 1-0 count now. Like I mentioned, he's 1-for-2. He's got 2 RBIs. Double in the sack fly. Squares up to hit. Takes a strike low and outside.
Beautiful change up. Clocking in only at 75 miles per hour, the bottom corner of the zone.
That was an impressively located pitch just to paint that outside corner. It looked a little low from our angle, but home plate umpire Jeff Doy calls it a strike. A 1-1 for Burton as Finchester steps off the mound and checks the runner Stewart at second. As pointing to Adam to show my mom has arrived with my dog.
I was wondering what you were pointing at. But, yes, a beautiful dog for Mackinac.
He's great. I'm surprised they let him in, but game's pretty empty. Foul ball by Burton. Lift over the right field wall. Foul.
At the corner of Meridian and Easterday sits a beacon of college hockey nestled at the eastern edge of Michigan's Upper Peninsula. This building has seen three teams of its own go on to win NCAA championships. And tonight, Taffy Abel Arena in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan will see the continuation of an old CCHA rivalry as the 3-1 number 5 ranked Michigan Wolverines travel to play the unranked 0-1-1 Lake Superior State Lakers.
I'm going to step away. Gregor, if you want to stay on for a bit, you're welcome to.
I can entertain for a little bit. The problem is the bathroom lines need to whittle down before I take my headset off. But a lot of fun here. You can take off if you want to. I'm good.
Tons of fun.
Hold my own.
I'll let you hold your own for a moment. I'll be right back on the broadcast.
So, Connor Irgood is looking at me right now. He's a bit stunned that there's this mermaid on the Zamboni. We are seated right next to the Daily. Seymour, T-shirt toss for us. Caught right in front of the press box. Seymour's got another one. That bucket's endless. Good one from Seymour. He's underhand tossing these. Needs to save the arm. I don't know. This school doesn't have a baseball team, so it's not like he's a starting pitcher. We went to the alumni tailgate, me and Owen, today. And we talked to a few of the mascot alumni that had made the trip out here. There were about 5 different suits worn throughout the history of Lake Superior State, and each one an increasing level of creepiness. And each one of those mascots had handlers because, as one of the alumni put it to me, when you wear that suit, you want to do stupid things, and we're trying to stop them from doing stupid things. I guess that's a fair sentiment. But they said that this Seymour, right now a student is being trained to be the mascot that skates on the ice, but right now it's usually a faculty member. which is just really funny to me. Imagine at Michigan, if the Wolverines did have a mascot. We have the Wolverine, but they don't have an on-field mascot. If your favorite professor was out there skating at Yost inside the Wolverine suit, it'd be pretty funny. I don't know which professor is Seymour. Maybe, you know, I don't know.
10 years ago, NBA basketball came to Brooklyn, New York, which necessitated the need for this building, the cavernous Barclays Center. On any other night, you're liable to see Kevin Durant and the Brooklyn Nets or Sabrina Ionescu and the New York Liberty, but on this particular evening, the number 20-ranked Michigan Wolverines men's basketball team takes on the Pitt Panthers in the 2022 Legends Classic. With Michigan up by two possessions, some fans head for the exits, but others want to stay and see if Imani Bates can pull something out of the hat. Farrakhan has it off the inbounds. Bates passes up on the three, pass out to Jeter. Jeter tries to get it to the right corner to Farrakhan. Ball gets tipped out of bounds by Michigan. Stays with the Eagles. 48.7 seconds remaining. We apologize for our scoreboard technical difficulties. Can't get the timer to go, but we'll get the right score to you. 85-80, 48.7 seconds remaining.
And Eastern Michigan got the switch they wanted there. They got a guard onto Bates. And Bates wanted to shoot that. He just passed it off because he had an open man. Michigan able to tip it away.
Acuff inbounds. Steps into a three-pointer. Acuff rims out. Rebound Hunter Dickinson. And the Eagles choose not to foul with 40 seconds left. Llewellyn picked up by Noah Farrakhan close to midcourt. Llewellyn still working. Terrence Williams has it now. No foul again from the Eagles. Entry pass to Dickinson, almost swatted by Jeter, and Dickinson will go to work. On the left block, Dickinson fade away. He knocks it in, and that might do it. 87-80 with 21.3 seconds remaining. Acuff races back down the floor.
Who else?
Eastern Michigan only one timeout, and Imani Bates is just sitting there.
This has to go up quick.
Bates hits it. Oh, my goodness. He hits a three-pointer with 9.3 seconds remaining.
Juwan Howard talking to his team in the huddle and at the Jumpman Invitational. That does remind us that Coach Howard has a little bit of an interesting relationship with the Jumpman himself, Michael Jordan. 1994, Howard, coming out of Michigan, was drafted by the Washington Bullets. Two seasons later, had a dominant rookie and sophomore season in the NBA, selected to an NBA All-Star team, second team All-Rookie, and he earns the first ever $100 million contract in the NBA. First ever out of any player. It was just the way the league was trending at the time, and he was the lucky man to get it. At that time, they changed their name to the Wizards in D.C., and in 2000, Michael Jordan becomes president of basketball operations for the Wizards. What's his very first notable move as a guy for the Wizards? He trades Juwan Howard over to the Mavericks in a blockbuster eight-team trade for cash considerations.
And Adam, I'm sorry I distracted you.
Yeah.
We've been told by the ushers where Michael Jordan sits in this arena. He's possibly to our right. We don't know if he's here tonight. It is a packed box up there, so it's possible he's here. They told us that he likes to stay hidden from the crowd so people don't mob him. It's understandable.
I would have to imagine he's here. It's his alma mater playing. His stadium, he owns the Hornets. His brand, his ESPN brand, this is a celebration of him as a person and all of his accomplishments in life, short of his stint in minor league baseball.
And the interesting thing about that trade of Juwan Howard to Dallas, it was for the opposing coach tonight, Hubert Davis. He was traded to Washington in that deal, along with Christian Laettner, who went to Washington, another big-time,
big-name
player.
That might be the one thing Michigan and UNC fans could agree on, is their hatred towards Christian Laettner. UNC fans hate him for being a Dukie and one of the most hated Dukies around. Michigan hates him personally for beating them very bluntly and not even close in the 1992 title game, the freshman year of the Fab Five. So Juwan has some personal beef with Laettner.
It's another matchup for Michigan between two head coaches who are alumni from their alma maters. Hubert Davis is born and raised in North Carolina, went to school at Chapel Hill, graduated there, went to the NBA, as we said, was traded eventually for Juwan Howard. Howard played for the Fab Five at Michigan, and they are one of two of It's around 50 coaches that coach for their alma maters in Division I basketball right now. Michigan had already faced off against Stan Heath, who coached his alma mater, the Eastern Michigan Eagles, at Little Caesars Arena in Detroit about a month or two ago. So another cool matchup between coaches. And in this instance, when these coaches played in the NBA, they were traded for each other. It's not often you can say that. But Michigan, down by five, they have the basketball. After an out-of-bounds call went their way, Jet Howard, floater from the free throw line off a Doug McDaniel pass is short, rebounded by Pete Nance. Nance brings it up for the Tar Heels. Love has it on the left wing. Love has not gotten active in this second half after a 10-point first half. Back cut from R.J. Davis, a beautiful pass from Armando Bacot skipped to him. Davis long on the looping layup, but is fouled on the other end attempting to grab the rebound.
Michigan's number five, Terrence Williams at second.
It's going to be on Terrence Williams. Third foul of the half. Something to keep in mind. We still got 15 minutes and some change of play. And if the first half was any indication, that could be huge for whichever team is leading in the foul game going to the line late in this one. First shot is up, and that's drained from Davis. UNC extends their lead to 6 points as they break the thrifty point threshold here.
And Carolina, Michigan, on the other hand, lucky to get that foul registered to Terrence Williams, who only has that one foul so far tonight. Jet Howard has three. Bufkin, Dickinson, and McDaniel all have two fouls. Seth Trimble checks into the game for North Carolina. He checks Doug McDaniel at full court. McDaniel calls from a screen for Dickinson. Quickly dives in, and a foul on the floor on Armando Bacot, trying to stay with the speedy McDaniel. McDaniel flipped that shot in, but the foul comes before.
Unfortunate break for the Wolverines, as it wasn't even a shooting foul. So but Michigan is fortunate to get the foul up.
And it is the third foul on Armando Bacot with 15 minutes left in this game. That's a big deal. And you could see Michigan try to go inside more to Hunter Dickinson to get Bacot further in foul trouble.
I can totally see that as this game winds down.
Dickinson inside on Bacot. He does it, and he puts it in. Bacot can't play strong defense on him with those three fouls. Dickinson flips it up and in, his first field goal since the opening minutes of the first half. He's only got 6 points. Trimble has it, the freshman. Entry pass Bacot. Bacot on the right block, working inside against Dickinson. Almost gets there. Nobody boxes out Leaky Black, though, rebounding that ball and dunking it home. McDaniel, again, guarded closely by Seth Trimble from the inbounds. Both zeros, freshman point guards. McDaniel eventually gets inside. He's fouled on the jump shot. Seth Trimble got him on the arm. McDaniel head to the line. Michigan down by seven, 53-46, 14-36 remaining in the second half.
That's going to be a shooting foul. Give Michigan two shots from the line. Tar Heels racking up the fouls recently, already up to five, and it's only 14 minutes left in this game. We still have 14 minutes left.
And these fouls are keeping the Wolverines in the ballgame. They're now 11 of 13 from the line. McDaniel, who has slid into that starting point guard spot after Jalen Llewellyn tore his ACL against Kentucky in London. He misses the second free throw, though, but he'd only been shooting about 78% from the line. Michigan now 11 of 14 from the charity stripe. It's kept Michigan in this game. They're still shooting poorly, under 40% from the field, 30.8% from three. And it won't be any better when Armando Bacot gets an easy pocket pass inside for another dunk for North Carolina. And the Tar Heel crowd is really into this game now. Michigan attempting to get a timeout called. They finally do. 14:08 remaining. Carolina crowd on their feet here in Charlotte. Michigan down by eight.
Michigan trailing 47-55 here in Carolina. And UNC's running away with this. At the very best, Michigan is trading points. And that just doesn't seem to be a recipe for success in how the trajectory of this game is going. As we said, it's a neutral site, technically, in Charlotte at the Bobcats court, but, pardon me, the Hornets court. But this is, for all intents and purposes, a UNC home game. Looking at the crowd, it's filled out. I'd say probably 80% attendance here, at least in their seats. I'm sure they've sold out more. Very much populated in white and blue for UNC. Couple of kernels of maize, couple of dark blue, but not a ton. It makes sense. UNC is just 90 minutes down the road on I-85. Michigan's a lot further, as both of us know, having driven from Ann Arbor over the past couple of days.
Definitely. It's a lot farther than Chapel Hill. Sitting to the left of us is North Carolina's paper. The Michigan Daily is here tonight for us. But, Adam, how has it been so far here in Charlotte? It's been a lot of fun.
I love coming down to Charlotte. My uncle and my cousin live in Ballantyne, a suburb of Charlotte. They actually have a small business in suburban Charlotte, right on the other side of the state line in South Carolina. So it's always a real pleasure to spend Hanukkah here in Charlotte area with my family. But is this your first time coming down to the Queen City?
This is my first time in Charlotte, not my first time in North Carolina. A couple years ago, I went to Asheville, but we ended up going around Charlotte. Also on this trip, I've been to Charleston, South Carolina. I've been to Columbia, South Carolina. Charleston to see my cousin graduate from college. That was a lot of fun.
Oh, and tell the listeners what you'll be doing on Saturday.
And Saturday, I will be at Bank of America Stadium on Christmas Eve to see the Detroit Lions attempt to solidify a playoff spot against the Carolina Panthers.
I'm not much of a Lions fan, but I'll be rooting for them because I want to see the Bucs make the playoffs, and the Panthers are probably the biggest threat in the South behind the Bucs.
It'll be a lot of fun. Later in the week, I'll be down to Hilton Head for a wedding. That's the whole reason I'm down here, really, tonight. Just so happened that Michigan, playing in this Jumpman Invitational, 14:08 remaining in the second half, 55-47 the score right now. Hauser pull up, very long two, no good, goes long. Isaiah Barnes has also come in for Jet Howard. Fired to Baker in the corner. Baker drives in, flips up a layup, no good, rebound fought for, and goes off Carson Cooper. And a possession ago when Cooper received the rebound and got fouled. It's not often that you see a crowd get that involved after a loose ball foul on a defensive rebound, but that really got the end zone going. Michigan still has the basketball. Off the inbound, it goes to Will Cheddar inside. Working against Joey Hauser, a great move by Will Cheddar to score it.
Just a simple up and under for Cheddar.
Another pull-up jumper for Hogard. That was a bit of a heat check from the mid-range. It's long, rebounded to Michigan.
And under 8 minutes to go. Michigan's got to go now. Got to start to make your run.
Down by 12. Bufkin driving inside. Layup's good. And it's possible they start this little flow of offense now. Now only down by 10.
No Sissoko in the game. This is the time as we see him head to the scores table to check in Izzo. Doesn't want to risk having his underclassman bigs in on Dickinson.
And he's only got three fouls, so he's still got a bit of burn left in this game. Walker driving inside. Wide layup. Good. Flips it high. Doesn't even hit the glass. The arcing shot goes in for Tyson Walker.
And Dickinson acting as a coach on the floor, directing traffic for Michigan.
Bufkin. Right side, Dickinson driving in. A falling Cooper goes to the ground. No call, and Dickinson gets inside, puts a shot in. And they'll call a foul on Joey Hauser. Reached immediate timeout, but it looks like Hunter Dickinson will come back out on the back end and shoot an and-one free throw.
And that's just poor defense from Carson Cooper. He just totally hit the deck. Trying to draw an offensive foul there on Dickinson, but Dickinson barely bumped into him, and an easy no-call for the official.
We appreciate your tuning in for WCBN Sports live radio coverage of the first edition of the Face-Off on the Lake here at First Energy Stadium in Cleveland, Ohio. My name is William Gregory. I'll be joined shortly by Owen Crain, Joshua Tenzer, and David Kraemer. The Wolverines and the Buckeyes will fight for the opening puck drop in about 15 minutes, but hockey is far from what's at the top of mind for folks all around the Midwest. Back in November, three University of Virginia football players were killed on their own campus in Charlottesville. When the UVA basketball team came to Ann Arbor, I offered my condolences to the families of Lavelle Davis Jr., Devin Chandler, and Deshaun Perry live on air. 4 months later, I didn't think I'd have to do it again. Brian Frazier, Ariel Anderson, and Alexandria Werner were murdered on the campus of Michigan State University on Monday. Brian and Ariel were from my hometown of Grosse Pointe, Michigan. Brian lived a few streets down from my house, and he was a grade below me at our elementary school. My community, my childhood friends, have been torn up by the violence that occurred in East Lansing only 5 days ago. At 21 years old, I shouldn't have to eulogize six wonderful young people, but our country has allowed it to happen. There needs to be change. This cannot happen again. I'm the lone Michigan native among our crew tonight. Anyone from our state knows the deep connection shared between our two biggest campuses. Anyone from our state knows someone affected. Back in Ann Arbor, while we are driving home from Cleveland tonight, Michigan is going to play Michigan State at the Chrysler Center. The basketball that will be played tonight is meaningless, and there won't be anything that will be able to take back the atrocity that occurred at MSU. But there is an opportunity to heal. We can just show how strong we are together in memory of Brian, Ariel, and Alexandria, for their families, for the communities of East Lansing, Grosse Pointe, and Clawson, and for all those who have been affected by mass shootings around the country.
The officials are going to agree with 1 minute and 39 seconds left in the power play. Michigan's going to take a faceoff. Portillo comes back on. There won't be an empty net for this faceoff. Too dangerous with Landon Slaggart against TJ Hughes. Michigan wins it. Portillo waiting for the signal to come off. He does. Fantilli gets it along the boards. Brindley stops it on the right side in front of the blue line. Now Adam Fantilli. Left side slide. He scores! Adam Fantilli equalizes it. He won't be held scoreless tonight.
What a play there. Fantilli, like you said, only a couple games this season held pointless. And when you need a big-time play, your big-time players need to come through. And that's what Adam Fantilli did right there. He was able to just walk in. I don't know if that was deflected or not. We will see, but either way, that was clean to
it
me.
It looked
yeah.
like it went right through the legs of Bischel. And Adam Fantilli, like you said, Peter, big-time players make big-time plays in big-time moments. Fantilli hadn't had a point tonight. He puts one in to tie it. 3-3 ends the power play with one stroke of the stick. 1:57 left in regulation. Michigan battling back to maybe force overtime. Still has the possibility to win it. Michigan wins the faceoff in their own zone and take it out. Seamus Casey on the right side to the corner to Moyle. Moyle, bothered by a couple Badgers, skates around, trying to find a teammate. He's got Luke Hughes on the left side point. Hughes' shot is blocked. Finds its way back to Moyle on the deflection. Moyle skates around, now left wing. Behind the net, across the goal line goes Moyle. Luke Hughes, it's picked up though by Chaz Lucius, the Badger freshman. His pass, batted around a few times. Kuhlman's nearly had a shot. Nasr inside off a pass to Nolan Moyle, and he scores! Michigan up 5-4! Oh my goodness, with 2:20 left, Wisconsin makes a critical mistake. It's their number one defender, Carson Kuhlman's, losing the puck. Nasr to Moyle, the captain, and Michigan leads 5-4.
Holy jumping. The crowd is bumping here at Yost tonight. This is turning out to be an incredible hockey game. The Wolverines have 2 minutes and 20 seconds left to win this game, end this series against Wisconsin, and go on and face the winner of Penn State and Ohio State. Holy cow.
5-4, 2:20 left. Fantilli loses the faceoff for Michigan. The Wolverines just need some good defense down the stretch. Carson Vanel, a shot on goal just over the head of Portillo, though, on the shot from Vanel, who scored the goal to equalize it earlier to make it 4-4. Now 2 minutes left. Michigan still with those offensive defensemen out there. They come away with the puck off a rebound. Brindley lifts one, trying to find McGroarty. It ends up with 24 Care for Wisconsin. Now battle behind the net along with Care and Caulfield. Caulfield sends it up left side, Bantle. Checked by Pearson. In the neutral zone to Stang. Sam Stang. Trying to find a teammate, it's Kuhlman's. Poulemans, who made the mistake on the Moyle goal just a moment ago, loses the puck. TJ Hughes, one-on-one, fast break. Hughes inside, scores! Makes it 6-4, and Michigan assuredly clinches a spot next weekend against the winner of Penn State and Ohio State. TJ Hughes takes it himself.
I'm speechless. I am speechless up here in the booth. I want to see that again and again and again. Forehand, backhand, over the right shoulder of Mo. See ya. It's 6-4 here. Holy cow.
1:27 left in the third period, and Michigan won't let it slip away like they nearly did last night. They put in two in about 2 minutes of game time to go up 6-4 after 37 or so minutes being held without a goal after Adam Fantilli's third goal. He's got a hat trick.
His hat trick. And we forgot about him. And we completely forgot about him.
It's TJ Hughes. It's Nolan Moyle making huge plays to put the Wolverines up two with under 90 seconds left. And the Badgers are going to have to pull their goalie pretty soon. But the Wolverines win the faceoff.
And a perfect pass from Luke Hughes to TJ Hughes. Unrelated, by the way. Not brothers.
And there's a lot of Hughes brothers, so you can get confused. But a Hughes
Certainly.
To Hughes gets Michigan up by two, and now they're just going to try and play keep away, keep it in the Badger zone so they can't pull away their goalie. Dylan Duke can't handle it. Neither can Mackie Samuskevich. Leitch has it for Wisconsin. Now Malmquist. A minute left in the game. It's picked off by Samuskevich, and he sends it an empty netter. 7-4. Mackie Samuskevich gets in the goal-scoring party. And with 54.8 left, Michigan's up by three.
This is that team. Goodbye to any naysayers. This is how you win a hockey game. This is how you say, we're going to beat Wisconsin. We're going to beat Penn State. We're going to beat Ohio State. Whichever of those last two teams they run into next weekend, the Wolverines sure as hell have a better chance than they did at the end of the second period. This is a completely different hockey team.
I'm as speechless as you are. Three goals in under 3 minutes. Michigan's up by three after being tied for what it seemed like an eternity. And we're not going to need the extra game tomorrow night to settle this one. It's settled here tonight in Ann Arbor. And
oh
a date
gosh.
Next Saturday on the 11th between the winner of the Ohio State-Penn State series will decide who moves on to play likely Minnesota and Minneapolis.
So the Bobcats 1-0, 14-18 remaining in the first period. Not the start Michigan wanted at all, but it's a start they'll have to deal with. Samuskevich behind the net loses the puck. It's picked up by Michael Lombardi. An odd man rush here for Lombardi. The diving attempt by Jake Kiernan. A nice poke check gets the puck free, and Michigan evades disaster. A possible 2-0 deficit staring them in the face, and Kiernan makes a great play.
Casey keeping that puck in the offensive zone now.
Inside, a shot by Duke is deflected. And off the rebound, it's sent back into the Michigan zone. Seamus Casey will have to reset for the Wolverines. Drops off to Ethan Edwards, back on the ice after committing that holding penalty earlier that led to the Bobcat goal. Edwards fires a puck towards the net, not even close, a little wide right. Hallam trying to fight forward in the right corner. Loses it after being bothered by two Bobcats. Eventually gets it back. Keeps it in the zone. Passes to Ciccolini. It goes right by his stick. And the Bobcats send it out. Casey's going to have to reset if he crosses. Maybe not. They don't call an offsides. Casey by himself inside. Casey shot. He scores! Oh, my goodness. Seamus Casey all by himself. The freshman equalizes it with 13:11 to go in the first period.
And Seamus Casey, that's going to be his eighth goal of his freshman career here at the University of Michigan. In his 37th game, bring him to 29 points off of a play that he started, a broken play happening just a minute ago, keeping that puck in. The freshman defenseman, you know, with all of the energy balanced on towards Quinnipiac's side, it's incredible to see how quickly the Wolverines can score and get this game back under their control.
And it looked like the Wolverines hadn't reset it over the red line as they crossed into the neutral zone, but it looked like they did. Apparently, the referees didn't call it offsides, and Casey just took it himself in the confusion, put it in, ties it up. Michigan 1, Quinnipiac 1. So it's back even. Just under 13 minutes to go in the first period, and if that last sequence was evidence of anything, it's that we're in for an exciting night of hockey here in Tampa. These two teams want it more than anything. Rucker McGrory drops off right side. Fantilli, just a wrister from inside the neutral zone, almost gets to the net. Peretz has to deflect that shot. And off the rebound, it's collected by the Wolverines, but Fantilli gets in. A shot coming from the neutral zone is called offsides. Runs into three Bobcats, gets into a bit of a scrum, but Fantilli keeps the cooler head and skates to the bench. No harm, no foul. So these two teams don't know each other exactly well. There's only eight returners on Michigan from last year's team that played Quinnipiac, but the last time these two played in 2022 in the Allentown Regional Semifinal, Michigan goes up 4-0. The Bobcats score three unanswered in the third period to make it close 4-3. Michigan scores three after that, and they survive, as the MLive quote on your screen says. Michigan wins 7-4, eventually advancing to the Frozen Four, where they lost to Denver in overtime.
You know, it's crazy that that was only last year. It feels like these two teams are completely different. Starting a goal this year for Quinnipiac, the Bobcats' own Yaniv Peretz. Last year was Dylan St. Cyr, a name that might sound familiar, as he is a longtime Big Ten goalie with presence both, I believe, on Minnesota, but certainly on Notre Dame as their netminder.
Michigan State, yes,
for a long time. And then, of course, the Wolverines. That was a team led by Kent Johnson, Matty Beniers, and Owen Power. Luke Hughes and Mackie Samuskevich taking more of a back role there. And Portillo maybe had a better season last year than he did this season. But I mean, these are teams that there are a lot of fresh faces, especially on their stars. Quinnipiac's leading goal scorer and point getter this year, Colin Graff, the sophomore transfer,
so
by
he
the
was
way,
a president in that game. And
from
we talked about
Union College.
We talked about Nolan Moyle scoring two goals last year in that game. And you just talked about those four top five picks that the Wolverines had. None of them scored in that game either. It was Jimmy Lambert, Thomas Bortolo, Garrett Van Wy, Michael Pastajoff, and Brendan Brissone for the Wolverines, along with Moyle's two, that totaled seven.
One name has stayed, and that's Moyle, the captain now.
And he's back on the ice. The Bobcats should be scared of the captain for Michigan, but we're back ready to play. 1-1, 12:25 left in the first period. Here we go. Off the faceoff, Michigan wins it. McGrory loses it, and Quinnipiac has a chance at an empty net that's saved by Luke Hughes, but he loses the puck, and now the Bobcats racing in. Adam Fantilli playing goalie. You don't want that. It's scored.
And who other than Ethan DeYoung?
Bobcats go up 5-2.
That's probably the nail.
That'll do it. I mean,
for the Wolverines,
you don't want Adam Fantilli, as much as awesome as he is, he's not a goalie.
Wow. I would say the Wolverines fan base is surprised.
If this was going to be a 3-goal blowout, you'd expect it to be on Michigan side with the talent differential. And a clipping penalty goes against Michigan.
Yeah, that's it.
So that'll be it. It's Luke Hughes in the box. That's going to do it. Quinnipiac is going to advance to the national title game. They're still undefeated in national semifinals.
Wow.
Michigan, for the second straight season, leaves the Frozen Four empty-handed after losing in overtime to Denver last season, the eventual national champions, despite advancing to their nation-leading 27th Frozen Four. Michigan will not win their 10th national title in their 100th season of playing hockey, unfortunately, as nice as that would be.
Yes.
With all those round numbers, they haven't won one in 25 years. It'd be their 10th in 100 years. But it's not going to happen this season. And it's another golden chance let slip by the Wolverines. It'll be the eighth time in the Frozen Four that they've walked away without the national title since 1998. So here from Tampa, with a minute 23 to go, the Wolverines will try and make it a little bit more palatable. Eric Portillo back out there on the ice with Quinnipiac up 5-2. 1:15 to go. And we've entered the somber space of hockey that doesn't really mean anything because it's over.
The other thing, we've mentioned it's something to watch. as we march into extra innings, it's almost 9 o'clock. I have an assignment due at midnight that I haven't even started yet.
Assignment countdown.
And in between that, I got to eat tacos. It's got to be done. So I might broadcast that. If you folks would like that, I can put it on WCBN2, have a little vlog-style thing. Maybe I come back out to the baseball field and, I don't
eat
know,
them.
Play catch like in, Field of, like in Field of Dreams.
That movie made me cry.
That movie makes me cry every time I see it.
So much. Like, my dad
when
was watching
it next
to me. When
Ray Liotta plays catch with Kevin Costner, oh, boy.
First pitch, strike. I was watching it with my dad next to me, and I was crying like he was dead.
Yeah.
He is not dead. Hi, Reagan and Vihan and whoever else is here.
0-1 on Hannah Katie.
I said there was a strike. I did. You know what? I do my job before
I'm just
I
trying
am
to.
Silly.
I'm trying to O-2. Get you re-energized. We're in the 10th inning. We got to keep it up.
0-2.
Andrew Carson, number 17, the senior right-handed pitcher. Coming up to John Denver right now is what the Michigan PA is playing. Trying to calm Carson down maybe if he's jacked up. The Rochester, Michigan native out of Stony Creek High School came in from Lansing Community College. He stands at 6'2", 188 pounds, third pitcher of the ballgame for Michigan State. In a situation with a runner on second, Cody Jeffress wants to score him.
Yeah, this is a big run here for the Wolverines. Is getting this to a three-run ball game. We've already seen how MSU has been able to manufacture pushing across a few runs with aggressive plays on the base path by Casey Mays. So I think just extending this lead, getting Mitch Voigt in, making this a three-run ball game is critical here for the Wolverines at this junction of the game.
And Jeffress has been named in the preseason to the Brooks Wallace Award watch list. The Brooks Wallace Award given to the nation's best shortstop. Jeffress has been a crucial part of this Wolverine team. That's why he's batting leadoff. He's had a great season. A really, really disciplined hitter. 30 walks on the year, outpacing any other Wolverine by 7. 31, excuse me, outpacing any other Wolverine by 7. He entered the game with 30. Ted Burton behind him also walked, but Jeffress, with his first inning walk, added one more. He'll be set once Andrew Carson completes his warm-up on the mound to attempt to score the runner from second.
And Carson with an aggressive pitching motion as he kind of comes from a... Looks like almost a three-quarter arm angle, which will definitely get some unique movement and kind of deception to his pitches.
So Carson gets almost the entirety of Take Me Home Country Roads to warm up, but we're back in business. Here comes Cody Jeffress. One out, Mitch Voigt on second. A chance to extend Michigan's lead, which has already been buoyed by Jack Van Remortel solo home run to left. First pitch from Carson, swung on from Jeffress, fouled backwards. 0-1 now on the shortstop. Jeffress batting .333 with runners in scoring position in this season. Not necessarily a threat for extra bases, but he does have a good number of singles. 0-1 in there on the outside corner for a strike. Carson locates that one at 82 miles an hour.
Yeah, that was a nice backdoor breaking ball there, just catching that that outside edge for Jeffries to bring it to 0-2. That's just a real nice pitch. Not much Jeffries can do about that one.
The 0-2 high had to be gloved by Brecker the catcher. Carson comes into this game with a 3.26 ERA, 3-3 record with one save and 38 and two-thirds innings pitched, 36 strikeouts and 15 walks. He's allowed 3 home runs on the year. One, two to Jeffress. He sits on it. 2-2.
And Jeffress doing a good job not chasing there and giving anything easy to Carson. really making him come at making him come at Jeffries.
Softball game across the way has gone final. Michigan wins in a mercy in the fifth inning. 2-2. Jeffress works the count full after starting down 0-2. Fastest we've seen from Carson today is just below 83 miles an hour.
And we'll see if he challenges him here with a fastball. You gotta imagine that Carson would come right at Jeffries with this 3-2 pitch.
The payoff, Jeffress. Base hit into left. He knocks it in front of the left fielder, Mays. Coming around to score is Mitch Voigt from second. And Jeffress is in there with a stand-up double. Michigan extends their lead, now 6-3.
It was a real nice job from Jeffries right there. A 3-2 pitch. It was an off-speed pitch on the outer half of the plate, and he just stayed right with it and drove a nice opposite field single into that left field, or opposite field double, excuse me, into that left field corner.
And for Jeffress, I mentioned he's not really a threat to hit for extra bases. It is his ninth double of the year. He only has one triple, no homers. So out of his 36 hits this season, only 10 have gone for extra bases. Ted Burton steps in, with Jeffress replacing Mitch Voigt at second because he scored him. Burton, 432 this season, his average with runners in scoring position. Takes ball one. At 90 miles an hour, does Carson fire that one in there? So at the end of the day, as we close the book on the outing of Ryan Schepaniak, he will close with two earned runs as that runner from second scored that he was responsible for. Second pitch of the at-bat for Burton in there, the 1-0. Makes it 1-1, a strike down low. One-one to Burton with one out. Swung on. Lifted right field foul.
And that could be trouble for some car in the parking lot.
The kids are after it. They want a free baseball. Looks like a little league team or possibly an elementary school team looking for that baseball. Burton, who's hit a single, walked in this game but has struck out, faces a 1-2 count. Almost a pickoff attempt from Carson. Burton slaps it into left field. This one's going to go down into the gap off the wall. Burton for extra bases. Scoring is Jeffress, and back-to-back stand-up RBI doubles for the Wolverines. Makes it 7-3.
Cornelius Johnson enters the game split left. Andrel Anthony in the slot. Schoonmaker and Matthew Hibner in the game at tight end. Schoonmaker motions to the left. JJ under center, handoff left to Blake Corum, and he makes a man miss. What a move by Blake Corum. He's rumbling 30, 20, one man to beat. He makes a miss, and he's in the end zone. Or is he down
shy
at the one?
Just shy.
Just shy at the one-yard line. Blake Corum made something out of nothing on that play.
Oh, yeah, he did. And that's why Blake Corum's so special. That's exactly why his name has been entered into the Heisman conversation. What did Jim Harbaugh say a couple of weeks ago? Blake Corum will get so close to you when he hits the hole that he can smell the defender's breath, juke away, and then cut it for a long run. That's exactly what happened there.
They just showed the replay of that play on the Jumbotron, and a lot of Michigan fans held their breath. Looked like a touchdown. Jumbo set for the Wolverines. First and goal. Corum up the middle. Touchdown,
oh,
Michigan. 6-0. Early lead. Blake Corum, the past two carries, carries the Wolverines into the end zone.
Second and seven.
And for how much we're talking about Nebraska being a multiple offense, I think Michigan is too. They can do a lot with their skill players out wide. Obviously, the running backs. The tight ends have also been a staple of Jim Harbaugh's tenure. There was a game last season when eight of them played in one of the non-conference games. But Michigan can do a lot with McCarthy's ability to run. defenses always have to be on their toes.
Here come the Wolverines. Corum back in the game. They'll hand it to him. Flea flicker. JJ looking downfield. Going to go over the middle, and it's hauled in by Cornelius Johnson inside the 30.
And we saw the flea flicker a few weeks ago resulting in a touchdown to Roman Wilson. It's just talking about how the Michigan offense can be multiple, run a little bit of trickery. They do the flea flicker on first down.
They've liked that under Harbaugh as of late. Honestly, pretty good coverage from Nebraska, but a good throw from McCarthy.
Good protection again to allow him to throw.
Finds the mitts of number six, Cornelius Johnson. Shotgun for JJ. Edwards to his right. It's a handoff to Dono. Dono breaks it out to the left side. Down at the 20. Good run. We'll see if he's got enough for the first. They're not going to move the chains. They're going to say he's just short. It'll be second in inches for Michigan. Excellent run from number seven, and Michigan really starting to get the ball moving on the ground. They're already well over what Nebraska had given up this season, 88 yards on the ground in the first half, really through a quarter and a third for Michigan. Corum in the game now. JJ dropping back to pass. Going to step up in the pocket. JJ is going to take off. Nine with space. Five, touchdown Michigan. JJ McCarthy using his legs, and Michigan's all over this one. 20-0 Wolverines here in Lincoln.
And Nebraska sends a little bit of pressure. A rusher breaks through, but I talked about McCarthy's ability to run with his legs. You always run with your legs, but McCarthy breaks through, breaks the protection, scores a long touchdown, and we've been seeing him run more often recently.
On second down and 14 from the state 40-yard line, JJ back to throw. He's got A.J. Barner over the middle, and a nice stick made by Aaron Brule to keep him from picking up any more yardage. Third down and 13 now at the Spartan 39 for the Michigan offense. Another third down and long for Michigan. They've converted two of them, each on the last drive. J.J. McCarthy, empty set. Five receivers before Donovan Edwards motions into the backfield to the left of him. Now Dono flares all the way outside. A screen set up on the right sideline. Donovan Edwards loose up the right sideline, but he's tackled before getting the first down. And it looked like with a burst of speed, he could have been gone.
And William, credit to all three of the receivers on the right side of that formation there. I believe it was number eight, Tyler Morris, Colston Loveland, the tight end, and Roman Wilson. All three held their blocks perfectly and allowed Edwards to spring forward for the big pickup there in the first down for Michigan. That is what Jim Harbaugh preaches, and that's why, right there, big pickup on third down for Michigan yet again.
First down and 10 at the 25, knocking on the front door of the red zone. JJ, two wide receivers left. Tight end Colston Loveland works his way all the way tight right of the line of scrimmage to the near sideline. Wide left. JJ gets the snap, drops back to throw. Pressure comes. JJ steps up, rolls right into the end zone. Touchdown, Michigan! Roman Wilson! Oh, baby, what a rollout by McCarthy, and finds his favorite target, Roman Wilson, for another touchdown.
Hey, we've said that a few times this year, haven't we, William? 9-1?
Absolutely. Looking at the replay. What an athletic play by J.J. McCarthy to get out of the pocket after the pressure arrived and delivers a strike to the right side of the end zone to Roman Wilson.
And we've talked about this so much with J.J. That's what makes him special, that escapability, ability to break, contain, and punish a defense even if they've been able to get pressure in. That is really difficult to do with how good this Michigan offensive line is. And then when you're able to even get a guy to break through, JJ's able to escape and still look downfield and deliver the ball accurately to his receivers, and that's what makes him so dangerous. And that's why last year he won that job over Cade McNamara, was that ability to create these off-script and off-schedule plays, because Jim Harbaugh and this coaching staff knows that that is what you need to win at that very top level, to win a national championship, to win games in the college football playoff. you have to have a quarterback that can make plays and create for you.
With his 10th receiving touchdown of the season, Roman Wilson now has the most receiving touchdowns by a wide receiver in the Jim Harbaugh era. 10 of them. And we're only 8 weeks into the year.
We've still got three more quarters in this game. I would not say he's done.
14 to nothing after the James Turner extra point. 1:55 to go in the first quarter. Michigan out to an early lead.
Penn State to start out, second offensive possession from the 31. First down and 10 for the Nittany Lions. Aller in the gun with a running back split right. Two wide receivers and a third split right for Aller. Fake clap, makes a change at the line. Aller gets the snap, hand off to Singleton up the left side, is tackled. Kenny Grant in there once again. First play of the series. Grant not in the backfield, but tackles Singleton for no gain.
That's back-to-back drives. No gain on first down. If Penn State's going to be in second and long, third and long, it's going to be a long day.
Singleton stays in the game. We have yet to see Katron Allen so far, the other star running back for Penn State. Nick Singleton has gotten most of the carries this season. Less yards than Allen, though. Second down and 10, 8 minutes to go. Aller drops back to throw over the middle. He's got a man. It's his tight end, Tyler Warren, over the middle for a Penn State first down.
And
tackled at the 50-yard line. Penn State goes quick. They're at the left hash. Aller stays in the shotgun. Fakes a snap. Michigan nearly jumps offside, pointing to the Penn State offensive line like Dave Falls started. No flag. Check out the line from Aller. Three wide receivers. Far to the sidelines. Handoff up the middle to Singleton. He works forward for 5 yards. Tackled at the second level by Derek Moore and Kenny Grant, both in there on the stop for Michigan.
And that 5 yard carry on first down, that is very important. Second and 5 or second and 10, big difference.
Two wide receivers all the way towards the far sideline for Aller, who stays in the shotgun once again. There's a peach emoji sign displayed prominently on the Penn State sideline. Second down and 5. 6:50 to go in the first quarter. Handoff up the middle. Singleton once again, and he gets another big play of 6. And it's a big play in this game with how good these defenses are. A Penn State first down.
Penn State almost in field goal range. Something to watch is how does James Franklin handle these fourth down decisions? Is he more conservative, as usually is, or is he going to go for it more today?
And Alex Falcon, a capable kicker. Aller, first and 10 from the Michigan 39. Claps once, gets the snap, drops back to throw, right side, Keandre Lambert-Smith, defended well by Will Johnson, but they'll throw a flag and get him for pass interference. To me, that ball looked uncatchable out of bounds. But Penn State will have close to a first down by penalty here.
On that play they just saw, a little tug. He did not need to tug at all. That ball did not seem like it was going to be caught, but that little tug right in front of the sideline, right in front of the ref, they will call that.
Rare to see penalties in the defensive backfield for Michigan this season. The sophomore Will Johnson from Grosse Pointe South picks it up. And Penn State will have a first down and 10 from the Michigan 30. A full house backfield for Aller. First time we've seen a variation in the normal shotgun. Two wide receivers, one on each side. Give up the middle to Singleton. Makes a cut. Breaks into the second level before he's tackled by Junior Colson and Makari Page. Not before he gets to the 24-yard line.
Penn State running game really starting to get going. Now they're in second and short. That opens up so many plays.
And they weren't really getting much push against Ohio State, but it has been easy goings for them inside ever since those two Kenny Grant interior tackles. They've been moving the football efficiently. Pump fake from Aller. He steps up to run. Wide open room. Slides down at the 13-yard line. First down, Penn State. And they're knocking on being the first team with a goal-to-go situation against the Wolverines this season.
And Drew Aller sidesteps Jalen Arrell.
Full house backfield once again for Penn State. Two tight ends in the game, Theo Johnson and Tyler Warren. Singleton still behind Aller on first and 10 from the Michigan 13. 5 minutes to go in the first quarter. Singleton up the middle. Singleton's got room, gets past Keon Sab all the way down to the 3-yard line. First down and goal, Penn State. The first goal-to-go situation allowed by Michigan this season. We're 10 weeks in. Michigan has yet to be in this spot. We'll see how they respond.
Yeah, for the Michigan defense, they need to hold them to a field goal. Let's see if they can get a goal line stand.
4.5 to go in the first quarter. Clock running from the 4-yard line. Aller in the shotgun. Singleton to his right. Three wide receivers left. Tyler Warren, the tight end, tight to the right side of the line of scrimmage. Press coverage from the Wolverines. Outside, inside give to Singleton. Junior Colson in there and makes the stop at the 3. Second down and goal.
And the running game has worked the entire drive, but what happens when the defense is so condensed inside the 5-yard line? Once again, running into the interior. Let's see if Penn State sticks with the run or they try something different.
Excuse me, I thought Penn State had picked up the first down. It's third down and 1 from the 4, so no goal-to-go situation just yet. Third down, Penn State going to the wishbone. They did this against Ohio State in short yardage situations. They do a kind of tush-push. Michigan, tight to the line of scrimmage. I think Aller got the first down. Referees are marking him just in front of the line to gain. See what the spot is on third down and 1 from the 4. Clock stops at 3:27 to go in the first quarter. They're unearthing the football at the bottom of the pile. We're still waiting for the call. And we're going to have a measurement on this third down and 1 tush push by Penn State. They come out in the wishbone, which is not an ancient formation, but it's about a 50-year-old formation. We saw Oklahoma run it in the 1970s. They don't run anything triple option-y out of it, but it is a mechanism for them for the quarterback sneak, which we've seen become the vogue offensive play call. And I think by the nose of the football, Penn State has the first down. So now, the first goal-to-go situation for a Michigan opponent this season. First down and goal from the 3, 3:27 to go, tie game 0-0. Number 10, Penn State at home, knocking on the door of the Michigan goal line for the first time this season by any opponent against the Wolverines. Big beef in the interior for Michigan. They're not short of that. Jenkins, good. Graham, Grant, all in there. Penn State in the wishbone once again, but they motion Singleton out wide left. It's a give, left side. Nice tackle made by Mike Barrett on Katron Allen at the 3-yard line. Gain of nothing on first and goal.
It looked like Katron Allen had the edge, but just a really explosive play by Barrett.
So now we're seeing some misdirection on the wishbone set for Penn State. Throwback football down at the goal line for two teams that pride themselves on being physical. Second down and goal from the 3, clock running. Aller breaks the huddle, and the Penn State offense is back out in the wishbone. Now a motion to a pistol set. Two wide receivers left, one right. Allen in the backfield for the Nittany Lions. Play fake to him. Aller drifts back to throw. Pressure comes, has to throw it out of the back of the end zone. No flag for a hold. That's what the Penn State faithful want. But it'll be third down and goal.
And now this play is probably the biggest play of the game so far. Now, if Penn State doesn't get it, will James Franklin kick the field goal or will he go for it?
We'll have to see. Third down and 3, 2:27 to go. Clock stops. Tight end in the slot is Tyler Warren for Aller in the gun. Excuse me, it's Theo Johnson. Now moves tight to the right side of the line of scrimmage. Aller drops back to throw. Fade route to the end zone. Cephas!
defended well by Johnson, and incomplete, they call it, out of the back of the end zone. Fourth down and three, and the field goal unit is going to come on for the Penn State offense.
And this decision for the decision to go for the goal line fade, a fantastic play by Will Johnson. This Penn State receivers are not known for their contested catch ability.
And the fade route, one of the hardest plays to execute in football. Interesting that Penn State would go to that after being sold on the wishbone. Field goal by Felkins is up and good, and Penn State takes the lead 3-0. The third time Michigan has trailed in a first quarter this season. The other two games, Rutgers and Indiana. I mentioned in the pregame, Michigan, after trailing, has not allowed a second score this season. They allowed a first quarter touchdown to Rutgers and Indiana. They finished with 7 for the game. J.J. settles into the pistol. First down and 10 from the Penn State 27. Bredesen in motion once again. Maybe the same play, and it is. A give to Corum, who gains about 4 or 5. Now the Michigan running game is working. A little bit of deception, a little bit of motion, extra blockers where they need to be. And Michigan now at the 23, second down and 6.
Now the red zone offense is going to be so important. Which team's going to kick field goals? Which team is going to score touchdowns? That's what this is going to come down to.
Trente Jones retreats to the sidelines, replaced by Samaj Morgan, who will line up outside of Colston Loveland, who's in the left side slot. Roman Wilson all the way to the right. Now A.J. Barner motions left to right. Bunch set left side for McCarthy in the gun. Gets the snap. Screen pass set up for Samaj Morgan, who cannot get away from Denai Dennis Sutton, who sits him down for a loss back to the 26-yard line. Third down and 8 for Michigan. We've seen that screen be effective for the Wolverines, but Penn State keyed on it there. Another third down and long. And to avoid kicking a field goal just to tie, maybe try and take the lead, Michigan's got to get a first down. Bunch set now on the right side for McCarthy. He's got Edwards to his left in the shotgun. Cornelius Johnson split wide left. Pressure shown by Penn State. Motion man outside is Roman Wilson. Another screen for Samaj Morgan. Gets a block. Morgan cuts upfield, breaks a tackle to the 10, down to the 5-yard line. Samaj Morgan, a trusted member of this offense as a true freshman. First and goal, Michigan at the 6.
Tremendous play call by Sharon Moore. The same thing just on the other side. Manny Diaz, the defensive coordinator for Penn State, brought the blitz, and JJ kind of sidearned it to Samaj Morgan, and then Samaj Morgan did what Samaj Morgan does, make guys miss.
And you kick out Roman Wilson on the motion, wide right. That probably tipped the Penn State defense off that it was a little bit different. Trente Jones comes back in. 7 offensive linemen on the field for Michigan. Strong eye set with Max Bredesen and Edwards for McCarthy. Excuse me, an offset pistol, more like it. Flag is thrown. Edwards works down to the 4-yard line before he's tackled. We'll check the penalty.
Before that play, there Barner was lined up to the right side. There was no one on him. I think he was screaming at JJ that he was open. I mean, he would have walked in.
Illegal substitution on the defense. It'll be half the distance to the goal, and it'll be first down at the 3-yard line. Michigan trying to punch it in. Now they come out under center in the I formation. First time we've seen JJ under the center. Hand off inside to Corum, breaks a tackle into the end zone. Touchdown, Michigan. The Wolverines take the lead on their third offensive drive of the game. 6-3 here in Happy Valley. Michigan responds big.
Blake Corum, 17th touchdown, the best goal line back in the nation. His strong legs can push the pile, propel him forward, even when he stops moving. He just pile-drive the Penn State defense in. What a response from Michigan in this hostile environment.
That's the response you're looking for from the number 3 team in the country that wants to be number 1. 11:56 to go in the second quarter. James Turner on for the extra point to make it 7-3. It's up and good. Michigan up by 4.
Minutes into the second quarter, respond after a Penn State field goal drive. They were stuffed in a goal-to-go situation. Michigan advances it in a goal-to-go situation, scoring a touchdown, taking the lead here at Beaver Stadium in State College, Pennsylvania. We're in for a good one, folks, I think. Michigan not willing to back down without their head coach, an elevated Sharon Moore calling the plays from the sideline. These Wolverines aren't much to mess with. I want to shout out the Nittany Lion, who is at the 7-yard line, just face planted on a backflip, but he was doing the dance from the end of the movie Napoleon Dynamite, which is tough to pull off. Canned Heat by Jamiroquai playing over the speakers here at Beaver Stadium in central Pennsylvania. J.J. McCarthy still with Mullings to his right. First down and 10 from the 21 for Michigan. 7:41 to go in the second quarter. Edwards in the slot right. One wide receiver on each side for J.J. Edwards sprints all the way over to the left side of the slot. And McCarthy will take the snap. Now a sweep motion from Edwards, who gets the carry, breaks a tackle behind the line of scrimmage, but he is tackled finally at around the 23-yard line by number 23, Curtis Jacobs, another one of Penn State's star linebackers.
J.J. had the option to keep the ball on that one. If he kept it, there was a lane, I think, for him to run. Now second long in the red zone. This is going to be tough.
22-yard line, second down and 11. Just over 7 minutes to go in the first half. McCarthy in the pistol. Loveland, another jet motion. This time it leads to a play fake intended for Corum. A dump-off pass to Loveland. Again, nets nothing. Tackled by Kevin Winston Jr. And Michigan will face a third down and long, this time in Penn State territory.
This Penn State pass rush has been so effective. Can the offensive line give J.J. Enough time on this third down?
A lot of moving parts on the last two plays. We'll see if Michigan keeps it a little simpler on third down and long. J.J. probably won't have a lot of time to throw a blitz being shown by Penn State. They've bluffed a few times, and obviously they have the talent to rush four straight up. McCarthy makes a check at the line. Beaver Stadium is deafening here on Veterans Day. Edwards motions inside, and McCarthy's going to have to call another timeout with the play clock running down. Penn State's crowd making their presence felt in this game. Second time on this series, specifically, this series of downs that Michigan has had to call a timeout due to the noise.
Yeah, and they are right in front of the student section, just deafening. I mean, we can hear it from here. It is. It clearly has affected the communication of Michigan, but this third down and 11. You know, obviously, you would like to get a little closer field goal, but. But about a 39-yard from here, I think your first worry has to be get this first down.
And that's a makeable kick from James Turner, the graduate transfer from Louisville. He's been an efficient place kicker for the Wolverines this season. Obviously replacing the third-round pick by the San Francisco 49ers, Jake Moody. But he has played well. Michigan, though, on the other hand, hasn't really needed the long field goal game this season. They've been so efficient on offense. 47 touchdowns, now 48 in this game. Haven't kicked a lot of field goals this season. Obviously, in a position against a great team, a great defense like Penn State, you are liable to see more kicks than touchdowns just because teams aren't able to work down into the end zone. 6:14 to go in the second quarter after the second timeout called on this series of downs by Michigan. They're at the 22. A third down and 11 after two jet motion plays. One actually ended up going to Donovan Edwards for a loss of one. The other saw Colston Loveland come in, fake the jet, flare out right, and catch a pass in the flat before he was tackled down for no gain.
Yeah, and on this third down, so you mentioned there was potentially a Penn State was showing blitz. I wonder if they show blitz again and maybe disguise it, because because we've seen Penn State rushing for, they have been very successful. It's 11 yards to go. That's quite a lot, especially on in the red zone where the field is so condensed. If Penn State drops back seven, I think it's going to be really hard for Michigan to get the first down. So I would be surprised if they blitz here.
Third down and 11. It is a spot where a defensive coordinator, especially one as highly esteemed as Manny Diaz, does have to choose. Are you going to send pressure or are you going to drop back in coverage? Both are equally likely here on third down and long for the Michigan offense. Driving into the teeth of the Penn State student section in Happy Valley. Edwards to the right of McCarthy in the gun. Now motions forward. No, he'll stay with McCarthy in the sidecar. Usually you see some running backs go close to the line of scrimmage. In pass protection, Barner goes tight to the line of scrimmage. It's just a straight give up the middle to Edwards. Breaks a tackle. Edwards inside the 10-5. Touchdown, Michigan. Oh, my goodness. Donovan Edwards breaks a tackle. Goes to the right side. And Michigan up 13-3. Another play on third down. Nobody expected to happen.
We'll have an Alabama scouting report in just a moment. Michigan certainly has something to prove tonight after two unsuccessful semifinals. William Gregory joins me now. He'll be on color tonight alongside Daniel Olson with Kellen Flynn at play-by-play. William, we're going to talk about Alabama. How are you doing first?
I'm doing well. Just had another plate of delicious barbecue and mac and cheese and a King's Hawaiian roll. We're feeling good today, especially these mountains, this stadium. I was reading a Keith Jackson quote. It's located on the elevator up here in the press box. The broad-shouldered San Gabriel Mountains circle this stadium. I mean, it's magnificent, Owen.
The San Gabriel Mountains, of which the sun will set over this evening. Just before 2 p.m. Pacific time, 5 p.m. Eastern time for those of you listening on the East Coast, we've got ourselves a football game. We've talked about Michigan. The gentleman from the Daily laid out what the Wolverines need to do. William, you've been scouting this Alabama team ever since the committee released the rankings. What are your thoughts?
I mean, I've been scouting this Alabama team ever since I was 10 years old. Nick Saban is just, I mean, he's the greatest head coach to ever do it. And to have this game, see him on the opposite sideline, is just a privilege for all of us. But this team is a little bit different from what we've seen recently. You know, Jalen Milroe is a very talented quarterback, but you wouldn't put him up there with Bryce Young, Tua Tagovailoa, maybe even Jalen Hurts. Definitely better than Blake Sims, Jake Coker, those guys in the early years of the college football playoff. This is a team, offensive coordinator Tommy Reese has put together a really nice offensive system around Jalen Milroe, especially in this back half of the year to accentuate his strengths. He's certainly not a pure pocket passer, and Alabama will want to use him in the run game, but he's one of the most effective deep ball throwers in college football. He was only behind the Heisman Trophy winner Jaden Daniels of LSU in yards per attempt. Daniels was around just over 11. Milroe was just over 10 yards per attempt. He likes to throw it deep. This Alabama running game is not as potent as we're used to seeing. There's no Derrick Henry, Mark Ingram behind center, but Roydell Williams, Jace McClellan, and company are two talented backs, and then obviously the extra man Milroe in the run game is a big reason why Alabama has been successful this year. But really the team is driven by the defense, and that's just the way Nick Saban wants it. Defensive coordinator Kevin Steele has just arrived for his third stint in Tuscaloosa as their defensive coordinator, formerly at Auburn and a few other schools before that. And this defense, it'll be multiple. They do play two stand-up linebackers, so you could call it a 3-4, but they'll switch to four down fronts. And it's kind of a basic 4-2-5 package. Two linebackers, an extra DB on the field. Maybe they have a very talented linebacker group. Campbell, Lawson, a few other guys, the DBs, Caleb Downs, Kool-Aid McKinstry, Terrion Arnold, two other safeties are fantastic. Mm-hmm. It's a very strong defense. That's the strength of the team. Special teams, Will Reichert at kicker, the NCAA's all-time leading scorer, James Burnup, one of the best punters in the country. This is an Alabama team that has stars all over the field, and Michigan has their work cut out for them.
Khalil Mullings, the pistol back for McCarthy. Couple of receivers on the right. They bring Morgan in motion to the left side. JJ looking to throw. Pressure coming. JJ escapes the pocket. Going to throw downfield. Got a man open. It's Mullings inside the 15.
And they had a post for Morgan. He was in the middle of the end zone by the end of that play. That was McCarthy's first read. Good coverage on the outside by Kool-Aid McKinstry. McCarthy has to work off of it. Roll left. I thought there was a hold on the left side. Didn't get called. McCarthy rolls out, finds his man. And Michigan now rolling it, able to tie this game pretty soon here. And the Alabama front is very physical, very big, but they are inexperienced. They've had a couple miscues this season, players shuffling in and out. Their center, McLaughlin, actually switched after the Ole Miss game from a spiral snap to a dead snap after they had a fumble. So there's been a lot of turnover on this offensive line. One guy, J.C. Latham, though, Bleacher Report, scouting report on him ahead of this upcoming NFL draft, where he's probably going to be a top 15 pick, said he's got padlocks for hands and finishes his blocks thunderously, which you want to hear from a big right tackle like him. He's about 6'6", 360, and you guys had a chance to be around him during media days. Talk about Alabama's lines imposing presence. I mean, I talked about seeing them in practice in pads, but just even out of pads, what are those guys like?
Latham, we got a chance to chat with him at media day. Yes, he is. Number one, he's huge. Number two, I asked him, I said to him, what's kind of the vibe around the team? Do you guys feel like you're coming into this game as underdogs with them being, ended up being about 2.5-point underdogs according to Vegas, and obviously the 4 seed versus the 1. And I asked this to a couple of players. Dallas Turner said, no, it's whatever. We don't look at any of that stuff. Like, it's kind of whatever. Latham jumped at it immediately and really went into how they feel like there are huge underdogs in this game, that no one respects them. So
it's classic Alabama kind of talk, though. And it's soon going to turn to night. And that's the great thing about the Rose Bowl. You start the mid-afternoon sun blazing. I know when we were down on the field, being in these suits we're wearing, that was hot.
It was nice, though. A nice change up from.
Yeah. Up here in the shade, I'm a little chilly now, I have to say. But yeah.
I'm feeling pretty good. It's a good temp. A lot better than Ann Arbor.
Yeah.
I don't even want to think about the next 3 months of Ann Arbor gray that are coming.
Well, and that's the mystique of the Rose Bowl. I mean, sitting in the snow and the freezing rain for
Jim Harbaugh talked about in his presser.
Your entire life, and then you come out here, like you said, the palm trees. It's just something different.
You talked about being a little kid. You've got your laying on the floor with your
feet up and your hands on your chin.
Like this.
What a character.
He said it's the reason why so many Midwesterners move out to
California. It was a lot of fun to listen to Harbaugh speak this week and his mannerisms and
all three of us living in Michigan right now outside of being at the University of Michigan. I mean, for me, like, California was some island out there. It maybe didn't even exist until I got here. I wasn't sure that it was real. But now I'm here, and it's crazy.
We're almost back to the action now. Alabama trotting their offense onto the field. They have been stymied by this Michigan defense pretty much the whole game.
And, I mean, what happened to everything Michigan was doing offensively in the first half? Inside, outside, power, zone. It's not that they were doing everything they wanted to do and the Tide were allowing it, but that mix-up of stuff kind of can balance the talent differential that these two teams have. Michigan is not a five-star-laden team. If so many people talked about it in the preseason. If Michigan wanted to win the national title, they'd have to buck every single trend because every team that has won it in the playoff era recruits at the highest level. And the way that you take away the talent disparity is through your scheme. And Michigan has stood up defensively, I think, but offensively, if you want McCarthy to be the greatest quarterback in Michigan history and a first-round pick, he's got to step up. Yeah. And in this game, he really hasn't.
And I think Sherrone Moore has lost a little bit of that rhythm that he had early in the game where plays kind of flowed off of each other. I think now he's probably looking through, seeing what he can find, what maybe wrinkles he might have or what he used earlier that he can kind of build on and maybe even give Alabama a entirely different look. But the Michigan defense needs to stop just for an energy shift in here. You can start to feel kind of this
And you talk about stuff that's never been done before, streaks broken. Some talk before this game was Bo Schembechler's seven-game bowl losing streak that ended in the 1980 Rose Bowl win over Washington. 1981 Rose Bowl, I can't remember. And Jim Harbaugh and this Michigan team riding a six-game bowl losing streak, three straight playoff losses. Harbaugh's only won one bowl game in his Michigan head coach tenure, first year beating Florida 41-7 in 2015. Alabama's been here almost every year, and you got to overcome a mountain right now if you're the Wolverines.
Alabama's won three national championships in the college football playoff era, six under Nick Saban. This is the standard.
And Tyler Booker said he drew some ire talking towards former Georgia player and ESPN analyst David Pollack, saying the Alabama standard can never be replicated, only imitated. And the Tide are back on the biggest stage after beating Georgia, who some saw as going for their crown.
Down 2:20 to go in the Rose Bowl. McCarthy with a big play with his legs there. Drops back the pass. JJ stepping up in the pocket, looking for Wilson, and he's got it! Roman Wilson inside the 10, and he's down at the 6. McCarthy put that on a dime for Roman Wilson, and Michigan's in business.
That was an unbelievable stretch and catch by almost. That ball was actually tipped, I think, at the line of scrimmage.
I think you're right.
It floated.
Caught a little bit more air, and Wilson able to adjust, make the catch right in front of Malachi Moore and get inside the 5. And now this is where clock management is so huge.
If Roman Wilson doesn't snatch that ball, that's a pick going potentially the other way.
Certainly is.
And you talk about your biggest three players, Corum, McCarthy, Roman. Three gains to get down to the goal line.
Nick Saban's going to need a timeout.
He's going to need a timeout.
The Michigan sideline erupts. This is college football at its best, ladies and gentlemen. 2013 in the Rose Bowl. Alabama up 7. Michigan under 2 minutes to go. Knocking at the door, 5 yards away from potentially tying this ball game up. It hasn't had a lot of the crazy huge plays and major splash plays, but this has been a fantastic football game from start to finish. So Michigan gets the football first and makes Bama pay. All Blake Corum, excellent play design, excellent execution.
Yeah. Finally opened up some holes on that offensive line, and Corum using his excellent vision, cutting back and spinning out of tackles, using that strength. Something about Blake Corum, he's a little slippery at times. And
well, he's a shorter guy than you'd expect him to be. He's only about 5'7", 5'8", and that works to a running back favor. He's so built down low. But talk about a guy who's seeing it. Late in the game, getting better as it goes on. I'm seeing the stage in the tunnel with the roses out in front.
Michigan is a stop away from winning the Rose Bowl and advancing to the national championship game. Jalen Milroe will operate in the shotgun from the 25-yard line. This crowd is so loud right now. They bring Law in motion. Milroe's going to keep it and dump it off to Law. Law nowhere to go. Mike Barrett dropped him at the line of scrimmage.
The Michigan sideline, everybody was telling the defense, putting the hands up. They seemed like they had a little intel that was going to be some sort of RPO, and Milroe had nowhere to go with the ball. Michigan stayed at home, and I think that's the script, though, for Alabama.
Derek Moore getting a lot of burn in this game. I think he's played well. He has really set an edge there on that play. Discipline. Milroe has to throw that ball to the flat, no gain, or a gain of one.
The defense has adjusted well and gone back to their discipline these past few drives.
Second and 9 for Milroe. They bring a man in motion, and Milroe's going to keep it. Milroe with space, he's got it into the 10 and brought down after a first down pickup. So now Alabama has 4 downs, goal to go from the 8. Jalen Milroe doing what he does best, finding a seam and just darts through.
And just like Corum, using that vision of his to kind of cut back. Looked like he was going left. Play was designed left, but a big hole on that right side. And there it is. They've got 4 downs here to punch it in. And
he's the definition
better than this
of a playmaker. Ball on the 9. Alabama, 4 attempts to get into Pater. Milroe, shotgun. Lone receiver is Bond to the left.
turns and gives, and nowhere to
go.
Good
stuff. Good stuff.
Excellent shed there from Junior Colson to get in there and make a play.
Something to keep an eye on. That was a bit of a high snap there. Milrow handled it well, but with McLaughlin's snapping issues, a negative play like that would be so detrimental.
And we haven't seen a lot of penalties today at all.
And Michigan hasn't defended Alabama well at this section of the field really this season. In goal-to-go situations, though, Michigan not as experienced. We talked about it. Hadn't faced their first as a defense until the Maryland game.
Alabama breaks the huddle quickly. Second down and 9. Goal to go. Michigan going to bring pressure, and he's buried! McClellan is dropped! Mason Graham in the homecoming game for the Anaheim kid. A huge tackle for loss. Sets up 3rd and 14.
Graham set the tone early in this half, making some big plays on run defense. There he was, just shooting through the line of scrimmage and pushing Alabama back. We just mentioned negative plays, so detrimental in these parts of the this moment in the game, and got one right there.
Heck of a player, Sunday player in a few years.
Certainly.
Dupree, the tight end, flips to the right side of the formation. Milrow from the shotgun receives the snap. Good pocket, going to throw end zone. He's got Burton short of the end zone, and he'll be brought down at about the 4. Fourth down and about 3 or 4 yards to go for Alabama, season on the line.
Last time they were in this spot, it was 4th and 31. Touchdown strike to the left corner, and I thought it was going to be something similar once I knew that Milrow had enough time to throw that ball. Good tackling by the Michigan secondary.
That was Josh Wallace again.
Jermaine Burton's hurt, I think.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'd expect a timeout here anyway, but
Jermaine Burton's
like
got a cramp or
Burton's
something.
Cramping or something.
But Michigan, oh, man.
How much more drama can you ask for than this? I mean, we knew this was going to be a good football game coming into it. These are two really good football teams.
You're playing NCAA 14, you end the game. Instant classic.
Yeah. No, this is truly is the granddaddy of them all, isn't it?
You said it, William. This is regardless of who wins this football game, this is an instant classic game for the Rose Bowl, for the college football playoff. And
well, a send-off for the 4-team playoff, a send-off for a Big Ten team, guaranteed a spot in the Rose Bowl this season. We'll move to the 12-team playoff where so many more teams will have the opportunity. But this game, for the longest time, has been the most important postseason game for so many people, for a sport that until 25, 30 years ago did not have a game to decide a single national champion. And not that this will, but it certainly provides a structure, and the sport moves to a modern era. This is a game where it blends its age and all of this tumult on the college football landscape. It's the
all
old
right.
with the new.
So, fourth down and 3. 3 yards needed for Alabama. It's got to be Milrow.
I would assume. I think Reese probably goes to that RPO package and lets Milrow make a decision. Michigan's done a good job of staying at home. I wouldn't be surprised to see another timeout here, though. But, man, oh, man, 3 yards for history.
3 yards to go. Season on the line for both teams. 2 receivers to the left as there's another timeout. I think this one's from Michigan.
You got to see what's up. You just got to see what's up. Make a call based on their formation. I mean, man.
So we'll get another chance to talk this over.
Yeah, I mean, you said it, Kelin. This is Milrow, ball in Milrow's hands all day. I know Alabama's had success running the ball up the middle, but you need 3 yards. You give the ball to your best player. You give him some options. You put him in a good spot to succeed.
We really have not seen Alabama throw the football much today and have much success throwing the football. All of their success has come on the ground. William, I mean, would you be shocked if they go to the air here?
Shout out the Film Guy Network for diagnosing this. But Alabama, I don't know if they're going to come out in the split backfield. All day today they've been looking at that flat route, arrow route, where Milrow keeps the ball on a play fake. That has the ball in his hands, but also the opportunity to throw it short. I think that's what it is here.
Milrow in the shotgun. They bring Law in motion, and
another timeout.
Alabama's going to call timeout.
You can call back-to-back timeouts in college with no penalty. Can't do that in the NFL.
Woo! I knew those timeouts were coming. I mean,
You got two of them. Can't take them with you.
Yeah. I mean, they showed Kendrick Law in motion a little bit there. Yep. I'd imagine they're going to do that again.
So you also wonder right now, with the new overtime rules, after this overtime period, you have to go for two if you score a touchdown. Alabama, if they score,
could go for two
and go for the win.
I mean, it given the momentum that would create, I wouldn't be sure. Like, I think I
But
I
that
think
also,
I would,
that
actually.
Creates for the Michigan defense two opportunities to
get
end
a stop.
The game.
Right. I Well, yeah.
You,
it's, well,
you got to have
play,
two straight
right?
plays.
Two-point conversions from the 2-3 yard
yep.
line anyway, so.
So do you take Michigan's defense taking two straight plays like this or Alabama's offense? For me, the whole season, it's got to be Michigan's defense.
Michigan's got their personnel set. Jenkins runs off the field late. Two receivers to the left, one to the right. Milrow in the shotgun. They motion out Williams at the keeper. Milrow, he's short! Michigan has won the Rose Bowl, and it's going to the national championship. The Michigan Wolverines are going to Houston to play for the national championship. It does not get any better than this, folks. Smile and take a picture.
That's what we're doing, baby.
The Wolverines have vanquished the Tide.
Come
on, and have
man.
Won the Rose Bowl.
Low snap by Seth McLaughlin on the last play of the game, a design run for Jalen Milrow.
Harbaugh got over the hump. It took a long, long time.
And whoever wins in New Orleans tonight, Michigan will be the odds-on favorite in the national championship game in Houston next Monday.
Wow. It does not get any better than this. I mean, growing up a Michigan football fan, this is what you dream of. And to have the opportunity, I think I speak for all of us when I say this, to come here and broadcast this game under these circumstances for this school, there's nowhere I'd rather be. No one I'd rather be with.
But I do want to say, Kellen and I, as, you know, since middle school, this is nuts. I mean, everybody along the way in Grosse Pointe at University Liggett School, you guys all know who you are. I mean, we couldn't have done this without any of you guys. And this is the coolest thing I've ever done in my life. The last time I was crying on a football field is my senior year of high school. But, I mean, I can't even describe it. This is just amazing.
I mean, I definitely need to say thank you to my
thank you, Mom.
My mom and dad.
Thank you, Mom.
Mom.
I was saying before the game, if I were Michigan and I won the toss, I'd elect to receive. Washington is outscoring their opponents 333-186 in the first 30 minutes, 137-65 in the first quarter. Michigan wants to put a score on the board first, especially after starting out a bit slow against Alabama. Now, we don't want to see J.J. almost throwing an interception on the first play, as was overturned, the Caleb Downs pick on the first throw. But running the football, getting out to an early lead is essential for the Wolverines in this first half.
Kendall on the flip. Pistol set for McCarthy and the Wolverines. They'll run a play action here. McCarthy looking deep for Wilson. He's got him! Crossed the 50 and brought down inside of Washington territory at the 45. J.J. McCarthy with a dime to Roman Wilson, and that's a big strike from the Wolverines.
And Roman Wilson running that post route across the field kind of angles it up towards the boundary instead of running it so flat, just to get past Hampton, the safety, and what a ball by McCarthy, delivering that on a rope to Roman.
Put that right over the top of the safety, Hampton, and good protection from the offensive line there. Michigan goes empty. They motion out Corum all the way to the right. Morgan in the slot to the right. Three receivers to the left. JJ looking for Morgan, and it's incomplete. Nearly picked off there as it went off the hands of Samaj Morgan. JJ just put it a little bit off the body of number 82.
And McCarthy, let's look at the replay. Feet look a little
wonky there. I don't know. We've seen some accuracy mistakes from JJ on the back half of this season that have really just been head scratchers.
And that nearly cost him there. Elijah Jackson, the corner for Washington, dove out for that one and had a chance to pick it off on the tip. Michigan goes jumbo here. Edwards the pistol back. And they'll turn and give to Edwards. Edwards with more space. Edwards, 30, 20, not going to catch him. Touchdown, Wolverines. Donovan Edwards with his second of the game. And it's another long one.
Edwards coming in, six offensive linemen. The package for Michigan, they've been running that a lot this season. Jones, who's starting at right tackle in this game, moved to the left side, kind of in a tight end position, offset from the line of scrimmage. And Edwards, beautiful cutback to get to the right side. We've kind of been waiting for him to make plays in big games as we've had down the stretch like he did last season. Two big touchdowns in this one.
Turner's kick is through. And Michigan, the offense is humming early. 14-3 Wolverines over the Huskies. And it's been all Donovan Edwards for Michigan. 46 yards there on the score. He's got a pair of 40-yard touchdowns in the first quarter.
And like Will mentioned earlier when he was talking about the Wolverines wanting to get the ball first, them getting up or at least keeping it close allows them to use their script and play their game. And rushing is such a huge part of that. We've seen them, you know, dominate on the defensive side, and they've gotten out ahead. And because of that, they're allowed to use their, you know, lethal run game. This is exactly how the Wolverines would have wanted these first two drives to go.
And I'm not going to lie, driving in on the bus here, I thought about it. Thinking about all the Wolverine playmakers that we've seen so far in the back half of this season, I was thinking to myself, Donovan Edwards still has something to give. Former five-star recruit, one of only three on this Michigan football team. And really, nobody talking about him in the run-up to this game. It's Corum, it's Roman, it's JJ.
Penix dropping back to throw. Pressure coming, looking. He's got Adunze, and he missed it. Adunze was wide open, a blown coverage from Michigan, which we just talked about Michigan making mistakes. You do not see that often. Adunze had to turn to his back shoulder and got tripped up by his own feet.
Michigan was showing man coverage on that play. Slow rotation by Ron Moore. I think they dropped back into zone, and Moore went all the way to the deep middle of the field without checking where Adunze was going. Washington had the play to beat that fake coverage, and Penix pressured on the inside up the middle. That's what we talk about against good quarterbacks like Penix. You want to get hands in his face. Delivers the throw over the head of Adunze, and Penix, not a guy to make throwing errors like that. Can't connect on the deep ball. That's what kills an offense like Washington. Against Arizona State, the Huskies really had problems. That was a game that ended 15-7. Washington having the win on a pick six late was the only game this season Washington scored under 20 points. And it's one of those times where if you don't connect on the deep ball and you're an offense like the Huskies where you're chucking it almost every other play, it's feast or famine. This time it's famine for Washington. That was a walk-in touchdown. Penix misses the throw. He didn't miss anything against Texas. I mean, that was one of the greatest quarterback performances I've ever seen. 450 yards against the Longhorns, hitting on every throw, perfect, just where it needed to be. But the pressure from Michigan has affected Michael Penix Jr. in this game enough to prevent a touchdown on that play.
And a lot of people made comparisons between Michigan and Texas's defensive lines. Texas also with two unbelievable interior defensive linemen. But they're more run-stuffing specialists than pass rushers. And while Michigan's interior defensive line combination of Jenkins, Grant, and Graham, good in there as well. No Rayshon Benny today. But they're much more adept as pass rushers as well than Sweat for Texas. And so we've really seen that today, that interior pressure pushing the pocket like we saw against Alabama.
Wolverines, I believe, coming into this is the second-best pass rush defense in the nation. Like you Will mentioned, I mean, that was just, you know, the play was perfect. It was going to beat the Wolverine secondary. Penix just had people coming in. They were coming into his face, and he, you know, made a rare blunder for him.
That'll move the chains, but keeps the clock moving. Under
As we approach 2 minutes, pass over the middle of the field, incomplete, looking for Westover. Keon Sab right in there to make the hit and draw the ball free.
2:04 to go, 21-point lead.
That was the other tight end, Josh Cuevas.
I mean, you were ready for the worst in the Alabama game, but this is... I mean,
a lot less drama up in the booth, I can tell you that.
This is a feeling I don't know if I've ever experienced before. We're all Detroit people. Our teams haven't done something like this before.
Never. 2:04 to go. Michigan 124 seconds away from glory. Penix stepping up, and that is nearly intercepted again. Colson tipped it, and Will Johnson unable to make the play after it was tipped.
Two chances for it, really. And
well, Colson with that club on his left hand, tough to haul one in.
Penix was down after that play, and I don't think he's been completely right for the last four or five, maybe more plays.
You talk about a guy who's not completely right. Junior Colson has a club on his hand. That's why he didn't make the pick. He's had that for the past few weeks. Past few months,
had
really.
Two on earlier in December. Under 2 minutes now. Third and 10 for the Huskies. Michigan, free runner coming in at Penix. He's hammered and just has to heave it out of bounds. Michael Penix has been taking a beating.
Yeah, he's hurt now.
He's been hurt.
But that's a shoulder separation. I mean, I don't want to speculate that much, but he is, like, holding his shoulder like he can't support it.
And he's
his right shoulder. And obviously he's a lefty. He's had both shoulders separate once at Indiana, twice at Indiana. His off arm and his throwing arm. And right now he's not feeling good.
Two torn ACLs for Penix as well. Talk about a guy who's been battled through so much. Was a monster at Indiana, tore his ACL, transferred with his then OC, Kalen DeBoer.
Beat Michigan from Indiana for the first time in 40 years.
Followed Kalen DeBoer to Washington and has been a superstar for the Huskies.
Told him his rib cage, too.
Yeah, I mean, if you have seen when Matt Stafford gets buried and has to come back onto the field for the game-winning two-point conversion his rookie year against the Browns, I'm not trying to be funny. That's a similar way that Penix is holding his arm right now.
So Michigan calls timeout.
I know you want to keep him out there, but you're down by 21 points. And
it might be one of those things where Penix just is saying, I'm not coming out of the game.
I don't think he's that type of player.
I know, but fourth down and 10, and you don't want to give up. It's just
he's still out there.
You don't want to see more injury on top of an already kind of serious injury, especially for a guy that there was some buzz after that Texas game that he might go top 20 in the NFL draft.
Even higher than that. Backup Dylan Morris was in the huddle there, but stays on the sidelines.
And Morris, a Washington native who will transfer after the year, started two games in 20 and 21.
Three receivers to the right for Penix, who will throw, and it's incomplete. Michigan's going to get the football back. And this game's all but over. They can taste it.
And
Michigan 109 seconds away from eternal glory.
I do want to say that I was kind of proven right earlier when I was saying that this game could end in a blowout like the last five national championship games. It was so close for a long while, but now Michigan's opened it up, and it won't be as exciting of a finish as the two semifinal games, but for Michigan fans it will.
Yet again, Michigan's defense gets a stop, and this time the offense gets to come onto the field and burn the last 109 seconds. McCarthy on the field, Peyton O'Leary out there as the third wide receiver with Wilson and Johnson, and it's a handoff to Corum. Corum up the middle, no space there.
DeBoer is going to call his timeouts. He's got three of them.
That's what I was wondering.
Or no, I guess not. They blew the whistle like he called a timeout, but he's going to let the clock run out.
Well, I think if you're Michigan then, you enter victory formation.
And a good gesture from Harbaugh to get O'Leary a snap in the national title game, as Max Bredesen now checks in, along with Matthew Hibner.
Trevor Keegan on his knees, now up, just kind of absorbing the moment. A guy who will also be going to the NFL. You talk about a number of these guys. This is the last few snaps they will play as Michigan Wolverines.
Victory for Michigan, formation for the Michigan Wolverines. It's going to take one more kneel down, and then that'll do it.
How about the boys in blue?
They've done it. This is the team that all season had that kind of buzz. Is this the team? Every year it feels like there's one team that's head and shoulders above the rest. And it's been Michigan.
How about 14 points in back-to-back closing periods in the two semifinal games? 7 points in
McCarthy.
Fourth quarter.
Takes the knee. That'll do it. The Michigan Wolverines are national champions. Ann Arbor, party like it's 1997. The Wolverines are the best in all the land.
Where's the confetti?
Michigan.
Oh, clock's got to hit triple zeros.
Has claimed their national championship. Triple zeros, there it is. It's official. Your 2024 national champions. Wear the maize and blue. It's the Michigan Wolverines as the maize and blue confetti will fall through NRG Stadium. 2024, the year of the Wolverine.
Got to take some pictures just like we did at the Rose Bowl.
And there is no better feeling for every player, coach, staffer, manager on that field right now wearing maize and blue than this right here, what they're feeling right now. And Mitch is 15-0 for the first time in program history, and they are national champions. From sea to shining sea, Michigan is number one.
I mean, they did it.
Yeah.
Perfect season, 15-0. What a run these last 3 years have been for this team. I mean, this is the best roster that Michigan's had in these last couple of years. The defense, credit to the defense. I mean, 3 points, second half. I mean, what a showing by this Michigan team. And
I
happy for everyone in this program.
The Alabama game definitely elicits a different reaction, having coming down to the wire and having like a whole 10 minutes to absorb this feeling. It is really amazing. We're a bit subdued here, I have to say, but
it's different.
I think it's just the lack of like thriller ending.
Yeah,
Michigan. I mean,
at no point did I really think that Michigan was going to lose once they jumped out to the 14-point lead. I have to be honest.
And for these Husky players that are being showered in maize and blue confetti and slowly walking off the field, this is something Michigan, not at the national championship stage, but has experienced these last two seasons. And you see, everyone remembers the picture of J.J. McCarthy standing, watching the purple and silver confetti fall for TCU, the famous picture of Donovan Edwards, J.J., and Andrell Anthony watching the red and black confetti fall in the Orange Bowl. It's maize and blue confetti here in Houston for the national championship. And the Michigan Wolverines are number one.
I mean, Michigan saying,
boy, does that feel good to say!
I mean, they've been saying those who stay will be champions, and that's the case this year.
And now Oklahoma is the only team with multiple college football playoff appearances without a national title. They had four. Michigan finally doing it in their third shot.
Getting over the hump. Jim Harbaugh and his staff, everything they've done since 2020, the COVID year, when this program looked like it was in free fall. 2-4. Blowout losses to the best teams in the Big Ten. Losing to what was a really bad Michigan State team at the Big House.
Antoine Simmons, heck of a game.
To come back and do what they've done is flat out remarkable.
And we get to chill in here for a while. There's lightning in the area, and we've been invited to stay inside the stadium. So I think we're all going to get to know each other, all, I guess, 60,000 that are still left in here. Cheerleaders are playing in the confetti. Will Johnson, I think, should win MVP. Is getting crowned by Jim.
Credit to the defense. This was an unreal defensive showing against what's been an unbelievable passing offense all season.
They did it.
Jim Harbaugh just crowned Will Johnson.
Top of the college football world. Feels good to say.
Feels good.
No, it's I mean, this is what these guys work every day for. This is how you want to finish a season.
Michigan tripling up the Lion shots, 27-9. Shifsky wins another faceoff for Michigan. Another left-handed shot by Warren. He scored before on that. This time goes above the net. Ends up with Adam Conquest. Conquest up the right side, trying to get it to Sturzer. Now Conquest behind the net, fighting for it, picked up by Truscott. Truscott to Shifsky, the freshman. Shifsky nearly loses it, now gains control. Back to Marshall Warren. Warren trying to start the offense. Pass picked off by Conquest.
How can you lose with a name like Adam Conquest?
Well, the Lions are losing 4-1 right now. Conquest battling for the puck in the corner. Gets it to Sturzer. Three Wolverines around. Picked up by Warren. Warren not only with the goal tonight, but played well defensively. Price falls down on the ice. The children of Yost will let him know. Hallam up the left side. What a move by Jackson Hallam, and he puts it in. Second goal of the night for the sophomore. Oh, baby.
Jackson Hallam bet the lottery. What a move. Through the legs, that left-handed shot that just chips it up almost over the shoulder, over the blocker side of Burnham. And now Jackson Hallam, like you said, William, has his second goal of the night. An incredible move.
5-1 Michigan finally, after the Brindley goal earlier was knocked off with goaltender interference. And oh my gosh, we're looking at the replay. Kind of a god sham god move from Jackson Hallam on the ice. Sends that puck in, second goal of the game. It's 2:38 to go in the second period. Wolverines up by 4.
I'm not sure if it's something indicative of anything larger, but it seems like Brandon Arado has already resorted to potentially switching up the lines. TJ Hughes moving up to first line center to play with Rucker McGroarty and Gavin Brindley on that last shift. Whether it was a byproduct of not being able to get a clean changeoff, the Wolverines have been gasping for air at moments late in this first period with 2:04 to go.
Michigan loses the faceoff in the Ohio State end. It's picked up by Wise. Lifts a pass ahead of all of his teammates. It's lost in the shuffle. Tyler Duke nearly gave it away to Guzzo. He maintains possession, gets it to his brother, Dylan. Dylan, a shot is blocked. Deflects left side where it's picked up by Garrett Shifsky now behind the net. Shifsky, checked by Wahlberg, finds Duke on the left side. Big, big hit by Dunlap. And Duke gets the puck away. I mean, every single hit on Tyler Duke is inspiring this crowd. Working inside goes Casey. Casey in front of the net, puck still hanging. Tyler Duke off the rebound. Duke sends it in and scores. Michigan 1-0 on a wild play in front of the net. Multiple chances for Michigan, but Tyler Duke, the former Buckeye, opens the scoring on a Friday night.
And could you draw it up any better? It's something that only sports can provide. Tyler Duke, the villain, back home, a bit of an evil homecoming. I don't know whether to call it a homecoming or not, frankly, Will, because some might argue home is up in Ann Arbor now with big brother Dylan, but
we're not in Strongsville, Ohio anymore.
No, not remotely. Nor are we in Cleveland, a la the face-off on the lake.
Oh, boy.
All right, Michigan's up 2-0 over the Buckeyes of Ohio State. We're here in Columbus, Ohio, at the Schottenstein Center to broadcast tonight. And one of the most exciting things about being a member of a student radio station, the student radio station, WCBN, at the University of Michigan, is the ability to go on road trips like this.
Yes.
This right here. Also, yes. I should, you know, let everyone know. We got seven minutes before play resumes. But we thought we could talk about our mastermind behind all of our trips, always plans them out. So, William.
I love it.
We've had an exciting itinerary. Why don't you walk us through it?
So, the lay of the land today was multiple.
We got to start yesterday.
Well, yesterday.
We left Ann Arbor yesterday.
Left Ann Arbor yesterday. I was looking for things to do on the way here. And obviously, US 23 from Ann Arbor to Columbus isn't exactly, millionaire's boardwalk mile, whatever. I don't even know what I'm saying. Anyways, I found the tomb of Warren G. Harding in Marion, Ohio, which also operates. And I don't know, we saw it, we looked at it, we went and got Chipotle afterwards.
It was good Chipotle.
Stopped at the gas station and I got some banana pudding. It was okay.
And when else are G. Harding?
Yeah, well, and we thought that we'd have enough time to go to the Indian burial mounds that are part of the Hopewell culture that are around in Ohio. Just got recently named a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Didn't have enough time to do that, and most of the more significant ones are south of Columbus. Eventually, that's something I'd like to do. Then we got here, did the game. Afterwards, went to Raising Cane's, like I said on the broadcast last night. Got back to the Red Roof
Inn. Good chicken.
Red Roof Inn Plus. Tried to watch TV, but the volume was shot. Woke up this morning at the crack of. This is good. That was my first time to Waffle House. We got the All-Star Specials together.
I have romantic. Only positive things to say about it.
Afterwards, we went to the Ohio State Union, which is actually the oldest union in any American university. Not the building, but the actual idea of a union started here, apparently. We sat by the fire for a while. That was very nice. They have a lot of delivery robots here. After that, we walked around campus for a bit. Burned off the Waffle House food so we could go to John's idea, barbecue chicken, BBQ chicken. Apparently it's in the New York, New Jersey area. Had some nice Korean fried chicken. That was meal number two. Meal number two and a half was to go to Buckeye Donuts and procure a selection of donuts. John got five. I got one. What did you get?
I got a large Coke.
You got a large Coke. After that, what did we do?
After that, we went to Barnes & Noble.
Barnes & Noble, the bookstore, just walked around. Went back to the car, drove down, and that was in anticipation of the main event. Last year, I went to Columbus with my mom. We went to German Village. I was looking for a place in Columbus to do something cool. German Village is this beautiful, preserved neighborhood, one of the original neighborhoods of Columbus on the south side, with brick-paved streets, old houses still around, businesses. We went to the Book Loft. Then eventually we went to Schmidt Sausage House. I highly recommend that place. Second time I've been there.
Very good.
I got the meatloaf. John got the meatloaf.
I got,
Owen
the,
got the chicken schnitzel. Beer cheese smothered chicken schnitzel. Afterwards, I got a vanilla cream puff. Owen got an apple strudel.
With vanilla ice cream.
With vanilla ice cream. Then we came here.
It's an exciting
and,
day.
And we're looking for meals number four and five now. Maybe skip meal number four and go straight to five, which is, I think, Raising Cane's again. Well, yeah, Owen's got meal number four on tap. A cold grilled cheese that he hasn't eaten.
Well, thank you to the hospitality of Ohio State Athletics. They give us a meal voucher. I'm not going to waste my meal voucher.
I still have my meal voucher. For the folks back home, this is what we're working with. I don't know if it'll focus. But anyways, hockey. Michigan up 2-0.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Michigan leads 2-0 after a period. It's been exciting so far. William's our producer, so every time the volume changes.
Yeah, every time nothing works and the broadcast goes out, we will preemptively apologize. The Wi-Fi is kind of going. I should be on camera. Wi-Fi is going up and down in terms of its level. So bear with us through technical difficulties.
It's up and down, but...
Got a big nasty bird to the right of us. Herky the Hawk is doing a dance, and I want to say Herky the Hawk, he's a pretty lasting mascot. Started as a cartoon in 1948, first in costume at a football game in 1959. Herky is short for Hercules, and he's one of those bird mascots that has some big nasty teeth coming out of the beak. He's scaring people in the media section right now.
I'm pretty sure birds. I can check in with my roommate, Drew, who's an evolutionary biology major.
Birds might not have teeth.
I don't believe birds have teeth like that.
And
He's taking pictures with the kids. He's getting it done.
Hobbs up the floor for Michigan. Jordan Hobbs taking it herself down the lane. Floater won't go. Rebound Woodson, and the follow drops.
And Michigan's had the opportunities to get these second chance points here. It's just been too little too late.
Under seven. 20-point Michigan deficit, 89-69. Clark working on Woodson. Step back, hesitation, little blow by into the lane. That's good for two more.
I mean,
Clark at 44.
I've seen a similar Allen Iverson bucket before. Finger roll.
Hanson to Woodson. Near side wing, Woodson into the lane and draws a contact, and that's going to drop. And one opportunity now for Woodson.
But that snatch dribble, I mean.
I thought she was going to rip that.
Oh, man.
I believe the foul was on. It was Kate Martin that picked it up, so that's her second. And
I think you saw Caitlin Clark's eyes get wide when she saw Woodson get switched onto her. That's me for the Tiger.
Coming over to get some water at the bench, but not checking out of the game. Free throw good from Woodson. Davis feeds Clark on the left side. Clark.
Got her again.
Into the lane. Tried to feed it to the corner. That's off of a Navy Michigan jersey. We'll stay with Iowa.
And you see somebody here who's 2 points off your career high and is not attempting to force anything. Still trying to feed teammates. She can get anything she wants whenever she wants, really.
6:17 up to Martin. Martin left wide open for three and dots the eye. 94-72, a big Hawkeye lead. Little step back from Hanson, and that's pure.
She was hitting those in warm-ups.
Clark, man. Up the floor to Stolke, and she can't finish. I mean, that's not even a fast break. That's just a made basket.
There's been about five assists left on the floor for Caitlin Clark tonight.
Woodson has it on the near side wing. Elbow for Camp Schrader. Camp Schrader guarded by Clark. Will post up, head to the left block. Looking for some space, and she shuffled the puppies. That's a travel. A Falter will check in for Molly Davis for the Hawkeyes, and for Michigan, it's stuck in for Camp Schrader. A couple more substitutions as Brett will take Hobbs' spot, and O'Grady in for Stolke. 44 for Clark, two away from her career high. As we approach 5:30 here in the fourth, picked up by Woodson, the freshman Wolverine. Clark will walk it up and give it to O'Grady. O'Grady at the elbow. Pop out, Clark, thought about the triple. Will attack off the dribble, dumps it in for O'Grady. O'Grady flips it up with the left, puts it in, and one.
She's got Hall of Fame dimer, I guess.
Another assist for Clark. That's 13. The numbers from Clark tonight, 44 points. Over 50% from the field, over 50% from three. Perfect from the line. Five boards and 13 assists.
3:49 now, another faceoff in the Michigan end. And Notre Dame, ever since we started to talk about Michigan dominating offensive possession, it seems like towards the end of periods, Notre Dame comes on strong.
Right.
To dispel any notion that they're tiring. They win the faceoff here. Mastro Domenico. Slaggart had slipped and fell. Could not locate the puck. Moynihan centering pass into the slot to Slaggart, gets away. Bavaro's shot is blocked in front of the net. Comes away to Michigan. Tyler Duke's got it. Duke across to the neutral zone to Dylan Duke, his brother. And it's kept by Bavaro. Bavaro up to Landon Slaggart, the captain for Notre Dame. Up the right side. Feathered in. Knocked away by Duke. Picked up, though, by Mastro Domenico at the blue line. Right side, Bavaro, who's gotten a lot of ice time in this third period. His shot winds around the boards where it's reset by Notre Dame's Mastro Domenico. Into the neutral zone. Broken up, TJ Hughes leads to a chance for Gavin Brindley. First line out there for Michigan. McGrory skates inside. Tries a wraparound. He lost it on a nifty move. Back to Warren. Slap shot. Buried. Scored. Michigan up 2-1.
kind of a muffin from up top by Marshall Warren. That puck gets through traffic. Hey, bodies up front. Mitchell can't see it, and that puck finds the back of the net. That's 2-1 Wolverines.
And there's not a lot of goaltenders that can stop that big lefty shot from Marshall Warren, the grad transfer, former Boston College captain. Puts Michigan up one goal with 2:57 to go in the third period.
You think Bishop wishes he had that one back?
Oh, man. High drama here from Yost Ice Arena on senior night. Home ice in the Big Ten quarterfinals on the line. It's now at 7, 34-27. 20 seconds into the second half. The second free throw goes down for Thornton. He's got 10 today. McDaniel crosses the timeline. Left wing to Mari Burnett. Looking for an outlet. It's Will Cheddar on the top of the three-point line inside of Terrace Reed Jr. on the right block. Reed Jr. in on Akpara. Hook shot. We've seen it a number of times from Reed. This time too strong. Rebounded by the Buckeyes.
Terrace Reed Jr. has been struggling to get a lucky bounce. He has put up three shots and not one has fallen in his favor.
Bruce Thornton walks into a three-point shot, misses short, rebounded by Terrence Williams the second. To forecourt goes Doug McDaniel. McDaniel drove in for a moment, backed out. Now across from left to right, whips a pass left wing for three, Namari Burnett. Short off left iron. Rebounded by the Buckeyes.
That's the first three-point attempt from Burnett so far tonight. Second one for the... No, apologies. The sixth attempt for the Wolverines from the three-point line. They are now shooting 33% there compared to Ohio State's 14%.
Yeah, only one for seven for Ohio State.
Yeah, one for seven. Both teams struggling to warm up outside the perimeter. This has definitely been a driving game.
It was a rebound by Evan Mahaffey off to Bruce Thornton, who was fouled under the rim. No shooting foul called. Stoppage in play, side out. Yo-Yo, Yusuf Kayat checks into the game for the Wolverines, Namari Burnett, and Ohio State takes it from the sideline. Thornton, right corner to Gale Jr., up and over Yusuf Kayat. Reverse layup goes, and Roddy Gale Jr. picks on the sophomore into the game for the first time. 36-27, Ohio State leads.
Gale Jr., number one, another leading scorer for the Ohio Buckeyes, averaging around 13.8 points per game.
Terrence Williams the second on the left wing into Terrace Reed Jr. High catch, works inside to the left block against Okpara, who's giving him trouble. Reed, drop step move, hook shot again from the left side, is too strong, off the glass, doesn't even hit the rim. Bruce Thornton in transition, right side to Mahaffey, who puts a layup up and in.
Buckeyes really capitalizing on that momentum from transition, picking up those mistakes from the Wolverines and turning it into a momentous moment for them.
Kayat to Reed Jr. up top. Hand off McDaniel. Long three from the edge of Ohio. Goes short off the rim. There's a big, darker, wood-stained Ohio at center court. The Buckeyes in transition. Roddy Gale Jr. lays one off to Felix Okpara, who slams it home, and Ohio State forces Michigan to call a timeout, up 13 with 17:29 to go in the second half.
What a great pocket opening from Felix Okpara. He's come onto the court, and he really knows how to use his height to his advantage under the net there, and capitalizing again on a little bit of an opening from the Wolverines. Seeing some of that sloppy play from the Wolverines, not so much from the Buckeyes. They're looking really clean right now. They're looking really tight. I mean, and just like that, this is a 13-point game.
And for Ohio State, a big contribution so far in the second half from Felix Okpara, who's 6'11", a sophomore from Lagos, Nigeria, the lone international player on this Buckeye squad. Evan Mahaffey, also coming off the bench, a sophomore from Archbishop Moeller in Cincinnati, Ohio, has looked good, along with Roddy Gale Jr., who put the layup up and over. Yusuf Kayat, Michigan, looking very slow to start this second half. And KG, we talked about at the break, the lack of effort and the lack of urgency that we see from the Wolverines right now. How can you just get a spark? I mean, you're in Columbus. This crowd is into it, even though these two teams, this is not a big matchup in terms of conference magnitude, but it is the biggest rivalry for these two schools. And Michigan just seems to be sleepwalking out there.
I know, it's frustrating, and I don't know what sort of shot of vitamin B that they need to care a little bit here. I think right now the fear might be kicking in as this went from a 5-point game to a 13-point game. Maybe this timeout can be a moment of like, this is going to get away from us super quickly if we don't lock in right now. And honestly, the next 4 or 5 minutes of play are going to be really, really important because the Buckeyes can either pull away really fast or Wolverines can creep back in and make these last 10 minutes something really worth watching. But in this timeout right now, they have to decide if they want to feed off of this energy or walk out of here with their heads down.
Here's Owen Spencer. Pump fake into the lane. Spencer, his shot rims out, and this crowd wanted it for the senior. Steal for Ohio State. It's Bowen Hardman. Hardman working inside is fouled by Cooper Smith. And I'm not going to lie, I want to see it for Owen Spencer.
I want Owen Spencer to get points more than I've ever wanted anyone on the Michigan team to get points.
The crowd wanted it. I mean, it's a guy who has not played a game for Ohio State. He's from Cincinnati. He's the only senior that does not play on this team. The heart goes out to the guy.
He's a personality hire, and so they all must love him.
He's a smart guy. Going to be a surgeon.
Wants
Hardman.
To be a heart surgeon.
Hardman misses the first free
throw.
Like,
on his stat sheet, he has no stats.
That's one of his things.
But he says that he wants to be a heart surgeon. How incredible.
Second free throw for Hardman is good. He's the lone bench warmer to record a point in this stretch of the game. Inside of 90 seconds now.
Want to hear something funny?
Sure.
Michigan has had no field goals in the last 5.5 minutes.
Well, here's one for Jackson Savala from the right wing, and it rims in and out. Rebound. Ohio State had it for a moment. It was lost.
Yes.
And Cooper Smith, on the second chance, puts it back up and in.
Cooper Smith.
Cooper Smith cuts the lead to 26.
Yes, Cooper.
I've always wanted a just a bit outside moment like Bob Uecker in the movie Major League, and was glad to have that there. Cooper Smith outside guarding Bauman. Inside to Spencer. They're feeding him the rock right now down low. Owen Spencer, everybody in the building wants him to touch the basketball. He's fouled, and I think he's going to have a chance at the line here. No, they didn't foul Spencer.
Come on, guys. Read the room.
They foul Hardman again.
If I'm not getting free Chick-fil-A, I want to see Owen Spencer get a point.
Hardman, again, misses the free throw. He scored a career-high 11 points in 7 minutes against Nebraska on January 23rd. He's appeared in 14 games this season, and according to his bio, he's arguably the best shooter on the team. He's 2 for 4 from the line today, makes the second there on that possession. 42 seconds to go.
Who's letting these boys write their game notes?
They get to say whatever they want. Jackson Zavala's got it. Ian Burns, 3-point shot is no good. Rebound by Harrison Hochberg inside. The New Yorker is fouled.
Sorry, I had to take
a
picture.
Pause
so
to take
some
a
silence.
Picture. But
well, also, there's just not much to say here. We are watching the JV squad just absolutely tear it up right now.
How do you feel about Harrison Hochberg, who's stepping in the line for 2 free throws? He's from New York, but he went to prep school in Massachusetts.
What school?
Cushing Academy.
Okay. Hello, fellow New Yorker. Make the shot. Yes!
Hochberg makes it for the city of New York.
For me in the city of New York. He heard me.
84-58, last chance for Owen Spencer to get a bucket here.
Oh, thank goodness there's 24 seconds left.
I mean, we'll see if Ohio State makes a play. Colby Bauman's looking for him. Spencer's got
Come
it.
Come on, Spencer.
He's got one last shot.
No,
And he's
Spencer.
Tripped. Gets it back along the free throw line. Spencer, fadeaway jumper. No! Rebound to Michigan, then that'll do it. Everyone was hoping for it.
Spencer.
He looks like me playing rec league basketball. I can't shoot. Last second three by Cooper Smith. He makes it with 0.1 seconds left. Juwan Howard daps him up. And they'll just run out the clock.
That's all Juwan Howard has left to say.
Cooper Smith cuts the deficit to 23. 84-61, our final from Value City Arena in Columbus, Ohio on senior night for Ohio State. Owen Spencer doesn't end up with a point, but Michigan takes a shot with like 5 seconds left, and I'm surprised there was no scrum after that. A last second three, maybe Ohio State's, you know, you're down 25.
What are you going to do? what are you going to do? But still.
I mean, that was the most fire I had seen from Michigan tonight, was Juwan Howard dapping up Cooper Smith after a three-pointer with no time left.
Like sportsmanship, teammate chemistry was that tap up between
and,
those two.
And Cooper Smith takes the three-pointer from the Value City Arena logo on the left wing, falling away after he cans it into Juwan Howard on the sideline. It wasn't like he sought him out. They just kind of flowed into a dap. That would have been a lot cooler if the game was closer.
It would have been. There's a lot of things that would have made that cooler, and one of them is not cutting it to a 23-point deficit.
Bruce Thornton, the leading scorer in this game for the Buckeyes. We hadn't seen him in about 5 minutes after he was subbed out. Roddy Gale Jr. off the he's not off the bench. He's got 15 to be the Buckeyes' second leading scorer.
He's a sophomore that is rising for this team.
Yeah. And our game high tonight, Doug McDaniel with 19 points, 7 of 21 from the field.
Yeah, seven for 21.
Yep, 33% from the field.
Oh.
He finishes with a minus 28.
Oh, Doug.
Terrence Williams the second, a minus 32. Terrace Reed Jr., a minus 34.
Terrace Reed Jr.
But.
With those rebounds.
Cooper Smith, Jackson Savala, Harrison Hochberg, and Ian Burns fluctuate around a plus 4 to 5.
Oh.
In their time on the floor.
Oh.
And they're all around for next year unless they transfer.
Well, why would they ever do that? What could they possibly
stop? We gotta stop.
Mark Estapa on the opening, or excuse me, the face-off, following the opening face-off. We're about 90 seconds into the second period, won by the Wolverines. Truscott retrieves from his own end. Right side mold now, or excuse me, Nasr. Nasr backwards to Shifsky. Nasr, after a Shifsky pass, is dumped deep, attempts to get the puck to Moldenauer. Moldenauer retreating along the left wing, tries one to Shifsky, it gets away. Trevor Janicki racing down the ice with Jacob Truscott. No icing called. Truscott battling for it behind Barczewski along with Janicki. Moldenauer in there as well for the Wolverines. It comes away to the Michigan captain, Jacob Truscott, senior from Port Huron, Michigan. Estapa across center ice to Nasr. Nasr skating in the right side, wraps all the way around the goal. Estapa in front in the slot. His shot is blocked by Bavaro. Estapa off the rebound, gets it back in front of the net, still hanging, and it's cleared away by Carter Slaggart. Warren can't keep it in, and it's an icing for Notre Dame. A big chance for the Wolverines. Killed by the Irish. That does it for the Michigan power play to open the second period.
And that scoring chance, one of the key parts of that was the patience of Frank Nasr skating behind the net, not giving up the puck too early and forcing kind of...
Fresh legs out there. Keenan Draper set to take the faceoff against Carter Slaggart. LaPointe, Ernesty, Edwards, and Warren out there as well. LaPointe, after the faceoff is won, a shot goes through the crease off the left side boards, rebounded by Ethan Edwards, brought back into the Michigan zone, up ice to Ernesty, gets away, picked up by Paul Fisher, property of the St. Louis Blues. The third line D-man for Notre Dame attempts to set up the offense, but Michigan, a great forecheck. Keenan Draper in the left corner battling for the puck. Ernesty now against Patrick Moynihan. Back to Fisher behind the net. Big check by Phil LaPointe. Stays with the Irish. Up ice to Trevor Janicki. Left side now across center ice. Tries to dump one inside to Moynihan. Moynihan, a shot goes around the net. Picked up by Carter Slaggart off the rebound. Strand there as well for the Irish. And a penalty on Michigan. It was delayed.
It's going to be on LaPointe for the hit, I think. Yeah.
Two-minute minor for boarding for Phil LaPointe, and that is after the five-minute major boarding penalty that Notre Dame had in the first period. Following last night's Drew Bavaro checking Seamus Casey and getting another five-minute major that allowed two goals to be scored by Michigan with the man advantage. No similar advantage tonight. Michigan on the kill for the first time. And in the second half of this season, they are killing, coming into this weekend, 83% of opposing power plays as opposed to just below 75% before the new year. So the penalty killing unit a lot better as the season has worn on, and it's good to round into form at this time in the season. Notre Dame has it controlled in the Michigan zone. Skating along the point is Seedham. Seedham onto the right wing. Up to the point, Knubel. Cole Knubel with Marcus Stapa face guarding him. Back to Seedham at the top of the blue line. Left wing Moynihan. Moynihan tries to drop one off in front, and it gets away, poked away by a few Michigan defenders, but stays with Notre Dame. Knubel, right side Slaggart. Back to Knubel, up top to Seedham. Ryan Seedham, the defenseman, leaves it for Justin Janicki, high slot. Janicki, left side, Knubel whiffs on a shot, gets it to Moynihan, and his shot is gloved by Jacob Archeski.
And the Wolverines are playing very compact on the penalty kill, and with Drew Bavaro coming out, loves to shoot it from the blue line. I expect him to do so here, especially as Wolverines are going to play back.
A minute 10 on the Notre Dame power play, 16:15 remaining in the second period. The Irish win the faceoff in the Michigan zone. Bavaro controls across the Big Ten logo on the blue line. Right side Fleming, back to Bavaro up top, his shot. A howitzer is blocked off the left side by Barczewski. In the corner, a battle for it, and it's eventually cleared by Garrett Shifsky all the way down to Ryan Bischel. Here's Bavaro up the right side across center ice. About 45 seconds remaining on the kill for Michigan. Truscott to Edwards. A broken stick flails on the ice. Edwards controls for Michigan. Elects not to clear all the way down. Shifsky's got a chance here. 2-on-3. Shifsky's shot is off the stick of Ryan Bischel. Rebound. Not cleared by Notre Dame. 3-on-1. Shifsky peels out, and Notre Dame has it behind their own net with 22 seconds remaining on the power play. Fisher. Cross-ice pass to Maddox Fleming. Fleming into the corner, checked by Warren. Around the boards, past Brennan Ali to Paul Fisher. Now Ali on the left wing, back to Fisher up top. Bavaro at the point. Drew Bavaro, right wing Fleming. Fleming's shot is up and over the net. Rebound stays with Fisher on the left side. Michigan back to full strength. Pass to Fleming, gets away. Estafa able to clear it across center ice before it's poked back by Fisher. Strand in there as well for Notre Dame. Ali wraps one around the boards to Trevor Janicki. Stephen Holtz can't get there in time for Michigan. Another stick on the ice. No, it's still that same broken one, been out there for quite a while. Warren lifts one from the corner up to TJ Hughes across center ice. Hughes goes from the center to right and lifts a pass for Stephen Holtz that gets deflected up to Janicki, who sends it up ice for the Irish. Jaden Davis attempting to control for Notre Dame in the Michigan zone. Won by the Wolverines. TJ Hughes now on the left side. Hughes. High slot. Brindley, his shot goes wide left. Off the rebound, Luca Fantilli tries to wrap one around the net. Nobody's home. Brindley was there for a moment. Still stays with Michigan. TJ Hughes recovered. Seamus Casey on the point. Skating right side. Shot from the circle. Batted up in the air. In between Bischel's legs. Doesn't go through. Stays with Michigan. Fantilli controlled to Hughes. Back to Casey on the left side. Casey, nice stick move around Janicki. Casey wheels around on the left wing. Up to McGroarty. McGroarty into the chest of Bischel, and it's stopped by Ryan Bischel before a scrum in front of the net prevents the faceoff from immediately happening. A lot of action on that possession, Coby. 4-3, 8:56 to go. Notre Dame wins the faceoff in the Michigan zone. Bavaro along the blue line to Seedham. Back to Bavaro along the point. Tries to dump one in. It's blocked by Moldenauer, kept by Hunter Strand in the corner. Strand, backwards pass to Seedham. Seedham along the slot up to Janicki from the blue line. Janicki trying to get back to the puck. Trips Nick Moldenauer. That's a penalty on Notre Dame. And Janicki will go to the box for two with 8:37 to go in the third period.
That would be a great time for the Wolverines to kind of put this one on ice.
The first penalty for Notre Dame since the first period. And that penalty at the end of the first with about 10 seconds left after Notre Dame challenged a Michigan goal for offsides. Their second challenge of the game that failed. Therefore, they got a penalty for the first minute 50 of the second period as well. But Notre Dame has played a cleaner brand of hockey in the middle part of this game until now. Michigan has a face-off in the Notre Dame end. It'll be TJ Hughes, who has two goals tonight off of deflections. One by Seamus Casey. One off of a Rucker McGroarty deflection. It's won by Michigan for a moment. Notre Dame sends it along the boards where it's kept in by Gavin Brindley on the left side. Brindley to Casey. Right wing McGroarty. An immediate shot is off the leg of Bischel. Dylan Duke unable to put it in after the rebound. McGroarty from the right wing once again. Inside to Duke. Slot to TJ Hughes. Shot is blocked and Notre Dame able to clear off the rebound.
Like you mentioned, the TJ Hughes goals. I mean, that's what you have to do. Bischel up front, straight shot, is as good as anybody. You got to get crafty.
Casey on the right side almost got through the legs of Bischel. Bischel unable to glove it, and off a rebound, a charging Dylan Duke catches the ire of a few Irish. Nothing comes of it in the scorebook, but it will be another faceoff in the Notre Dame zone.
Yeah, odd whistle there. He didn't really have complete control of it. Dylan Duke just looking to follow through on that. Of course, though, going to take offense. And it'd be the same other way around.
1:23 remaining on the power play for Notre Dame. Quick score update. 5:31 to go in the third period. Ohio State made it 3-2 in Madison. That game still with implications for the Wolverines postseason. Garrett Shifsky in front of the net after a rebound. Notre Dame able to clear. Shifsky couldn't get a clear shot off. Back down the ice where Jake Barczewski will control for Jacob Truscott. 7:45 to go in the third period. Truscott charging across center ice. Right wing Nasr. Cross ice pass left side to stop. Inside to Nick Moldenauer, who lost it. The puck was hanging for a moment. Nasr couldn't come over and keep it for Michigan. It's sent back down by Notre Dame. Inside of 50 seconds to go in the power play for Michigan. They do have a power play goal tonight. It was Nick Moldenauer. Excuse me, that was last night. TJ Hughes has a deflected goal tonight on the power play. McGroarty has it on the left wing. Behind the net to Casey, back to McGroarty. Excuse me, from the right side. Casey on the right, now left side, Gavin Brindley. Brindley skates in behind the net, passes to Duke. Back right side, McGroarty. Rutger, pass to Duke behind the net, is deflected, nearly up and out of play, stays in. Rucker McGroarty on the right side. Into Duke, tries a wrap around from the left side, and the left leg of Bischel, and it's blocked. Brindley skates in. A few seconds to go on the power play as it goes out of play. Four exactly to go on the power play as we reach another stoppage with 6:41 to go in the third. Go ahead. I was going to say the puck found its way to stick in the netting.
The Wolverines, as deadly as they are of a shooting team, sometimes struggle on the power play more than you think they would just because they let it get cleared a bit too often. They set up really well, and obviously not everything turns into a power play goal, but they just let Notre Dame get their sticks in there a bit too much.
It'll be Keenan Draper facing off against Hunter Strand with 4 seconds to go on the Michigan power play, hoping for maybe something off the faceoff with the man advantage. Warren, that big lefty howitzer along the Big Ten logo. Draper wins it for Michigan, kicks it along to Ethan Edwards. Power play over. Earnesty from behind the net. Controls for Michigan. Tries one from the right corner into Keenan Draper. Gets away. Hunter Strand checked for a moment and had lost the puck for a moment. Excuse me. Janicki had it for Notre Dame up ice to his brother Justin. Trevor and Justin trying to get to the left corner. Justin checks Marshall Warren. Puck gets away before Trevor can keep it for Notre Dame. And it is off to Bischel, who leaves it for Paul Fisher behind the net. Fisher, a St. Louis Blues prospect, up ice to Trevor Janicki on the left side. Excuse me, it's his brother Justin. Too many Janickies, too many Slaggarts.
I agree.
Nasr digs it out for Michigan from the right corner. Moldenauer's pass is picked up in the neutral zone by Boltman, who sends it up and out of play with 5:47 to go in the third.
Coming
right now we're getting 14
love.
Kilobits a second.
Come and get your love.
Let's go. Come stimulation on the video board.
Karaoke cam.
Superstar is in the sky like a tiger. Find the laws of gravity. I'm a racing car passing by like Lady Godiva.
Go, go, go,
there's no stopping me. Burning through the sky, yeah. 200 degrees, that's why they call me Mr. Fahrenheit. Sailing at the speed of light. I want to make a supersonic more than you.
I never know if it's woman
Don't
or man.
Stop me
Doesn't
now.
Matter.
I'm having such a good time. I'm having a ball. Don't stop me now. If you want to have a good time, just give me a call. Don't stop me now. I'm having a good time. Don't stop me
because
now.
I'm having a good time. I don't want to stop at all.
Brian May guitar solo. Oh, no, it's the next one.
Oh, you can hear the crowd booing. They can hear us singing.
I'm out of control. I'm a sex machine ready to reload. Like it at a bomb. How about the whoa, 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 explode.
We're going to kill our audience, man. Oh, wait. Actually, yeah. More of you have come back when we started singing.
I'm traveling at the speed of light.
Play resumes in about a minute 20. Don't stop me. Don't stop me. Don't stop me.
Hey, hey, hey. Don't stop me. Don't stop me. Ooh, ooh, ooh. All right.
I like it.
Michigan, Michigan State, tied at 4. Overtime is next here on WCBN.
Alex Miller, you did hear Boogie Wonderland. Here we go, overtime hockey. How much fun is this? A tie game after 60 minutes, and the Spartans and the Wolverines, the most played rivalry in college hockey, will have another entry lasting at least 5 minutes. Double overtime if no goals are scored in the first. And the winner will win the Big Ten title for Michigan. It would mean their third consecutive Big Ten tournament title. For MSU, it would be their first Big Ten tournament title in program history, having not won a tournament title since their CCHA tournament win in 2006. Back when this program was last culturally relevant, they were national champs in 07. And with this resurgence of the Spartans by Adam Nightingale following the dark ages of Danton Cole the last 15 years, this rivalry has been reignited. And another act in the play will be seen over the next 5 minutes. Oh, it's a 20-minute overtime period, so a full overtime period.
A little bit of Kernkraft 400 to fire up the crowd.
Shaun of the Dead, directed by Edgar Wright, featured that song. What a great movie that was. Full 20-minute period of overtime, 4-4. Michigan State controlled off the opening faceoff. Michigan's got it. Pass off of McGroarty's stick up the left side of the ice. Nienhaus from behind the net plays it for a teammate. Off the boards, Casey, though. Puck was loose. Around the boards to Shifsky. It's picked up, though, by Nienhaus around where Jeremy Davidson has it on the left side. 3-on-3 for the Spartans. Davidson, pass broken up by Garrett Shifsky. Tries one up the ice. He's knocked down by Levshinov. Coming away with it is Dylan Duke. Dylan Duke skates in on Augustine and can't get a clean shot off. Line change for Michigan. New legs. Nasr, a shot. Deflected. Wide right. Picked up by Reed Lebster. Lebster from the corner. Down to Edwards, who winds one along the boards. Levshinov meeting Ernesy. Ernesy has it behind the net. Augustine trying to play it. Nasr now along to Edwards, who keeps it in the zone for Michigan. A minute gone in overtime. Edwards out in front of the net, deflected, kept by Levshinov for MSU. Levshinov up the ice, recently named Freshman of the Year and Defensive Player of the Year in the Big Ten. Seen the ice a lot tonight, and now the first line for MSU out there. Scary forward core have combined for over 85 points this season. Nasr losing it, trying to exit the Michigan defensive zone. Dorward, who's played well tonight, shoots one wide of Barcheski, winds along the glass, picked up by Gucciardi, along to Dorwart once again. Cues there and a stop up for Michigan, and it's clear. Gucciardi in a race with Hughes to the corner, no icing called. Sturback in the opposite corner with Moldenauer, comes away to McGroarty. McGroarty over to the right side, Holtz. Holtz shoots one in, deflected wide, into the corner goes Tyler Duke. Duke along to the blue line, Moldenauer, and a bad pass from Tyler Duke makes Moldenauer unable to keep it into the zone for Michigan. 17:40 to go in overtime. We will play on until a goal is scored. Augustine plays it from his crease. It's intercepted. Keenan Draper, a shot is stopped by Trey Augustine, the first shot in a while for Michigan. They're up to 33 shots on goal tonight. 17:28 to go in the first overtime frame.
So our first break in overtime took 2 minutes 32 seconds to get a whistle.
Both teams have gone back and forth. Neither has established that sustained possession we've talked about all night. For either team, win the draw, hold on to the puck, create space, and you'll create opportunities.
Draper can't win it for Michigan, and MSU sends it back down into the Michigan zone. Basgill retreats. He had the last goal for the Spartans at the end of the second period with 0.7 seconds left. Breakaway opportunity for O'Connell. Met by Seamus Casey. Good defense, and it's stopped by Jake Barczewski on the left side of his net. 17-10 to go in overtime. Faceoff in the Michigan zone. Line change for both teams.
That all starts as the Wolverines tried to cycle. They pulled the puck back through the neutral zone. A D-to-D pass goes awry. The Spartans pick it up and almost create an opportunity. Luckily, because I'm a Michigan homer. I'm sorry, everyone. Wolverines are able to box out the Spartans. Just an easy save for Barczewski.
Nasr wins the faceoff for Michigan. Edwards tries to control a pass to Duke. He is batted around. Warren from behind the net sends it back down the ice out of the Michigan zone. Duke to the corner with Geary. No icing called. Ernesty with Manisto. Manisto across center ice. Poked by Nasr and an offside call on Tommy Manisto.
Another quick break. Neither team able to find that sustained possession. The Spartans with the few opportunities, but Michigan's pushing them to the edges of the zone. Crucial, especially Barczewski is a weaker goalie than Augustine. You need, if you're Michigan, to push the Spartans out to the edges, force them to take those worst shots. Easier for Barczewski to stop.
McGroarty playing for Michigan off the faceoff, tries to pass for Brindley, it's intercepted. Levchinov leads one for Lebster, and Barczewski able to corral it off a ricochet, 16:31 to go in overtime. Quick stoppages after that first stoppage, after the first two change in the overtime period.
And that's a good example of Michigan doing things right again. It was a good shot, but it was taken from the near side hash marks. That's a low angle, low opportunity shot, and a nice easy save for Barczewski.
Hughes controls the faceoff in the Michigan zone. Brindley sends it back down. Michigan separated themselves in the faceoff category recently, leading 39-31. Warren off a lifted pass up to Hughes, gets away. Nienhaus retrieves for MSU behind his own net. Up the left side to Mueller. Mueller trying to play it across center ice. Loses it to Edwards. 16 minutes to go in overtime. Augustine. It trickles to his own net. He plays it for a defenseman. Here comes Sturback. Up ice to Jeremy Davidson. He misplays it. Moldenhauer's got it in the neutral zone. Up to Keenan Draper into the corner. Reed Lebster there as well for MSU. Shifsky around the boards to Casey. Tries a centering pass to Dylan Duke. Casey retrieves it off the rebound. Casey skating all the way along from the point inside of the left wing. Puck gets to Dylan Duke. A shot from Jacob Truscott hoping for a deflection. It is recovered by Carson Dorwart. Backside boards play to Levchinov. Up to Lebster. Loses it to Casey. Here's Holtz for Michigan. Dumps it deep for a full change as Michigan were only able to get three of their five new skaters out on the ice. Tyler Duke playing a pass to Sturback from behind the net. Holtz goes to Duke, and an immediate shot off a turnover by Sturback as he comes off the ice is stopped by the Wolverines.
Risky play by Holtz, stopping that in front of the net.
Michigan can't clear it. Basgill inside to Howard off a deflection from Tyler Duke. It gets away from Barczewski. Dylan Duke up the left side. He's got Nasr on the center and Ernesty on the wing, and he goes offside.
And a smart play there. Instead of dumping in, we saw, I don't know if you noticed it, there was a little flick of the wrist, a hesitation to dump. He held off and instead decided to keep the puck. Of course, the Wolverines go offsides, but Michigan needs to enter the zone with manpower. Don't dump and chase. Enter, pull back the moment you can, and set yourselves up for opportunities. It's worked four times tonight. It can work again.
4-4 tie. 5.5 minutes gone in the first overtime frame. Michigan has controlled possession in this overtime period, but Michigan State arguably has gotten better chances. Here comes Brindley now in the corner, trying to get to the puck. Geary from behind the net had it
for a moment before Hughes poked it loose, and it's sent back down towards the Michigan end for an icing.
Well, William, I've given a long list of things to watch out for, including face-off wins, possession time. Let me add another. Breakout ability. Michigan State's most recent chances all came because the Wolverines were unable to break the puck out. If you can't do that, you can't control the puck, and you allow the other team to control and generate those opportunities. Michigan now, a far side draw in the Michigan State zone. If Michigan State can't break the puck out, the Wolverines will have more chances.
Estapa wins the faceoff, controlled by Casey on the left side. Casey, a shot! Goes wide right off the rebound kept by Truscott. Truscott from the corner, back out to the blue line. Casey now on the right side. Casey trying to deke out O'Connell, who pokes it away, and O'Connell's got it for MSU on a fast break. Three Wolverines there waiting for him. He dumps it off to Larson, and Larson gives it away to Estapa. Estapa tries to manufacture a fast break up to Casey on the left side. Draper there as well. It gets away, and a chance now for Manisto for the Spartans. Holtz there to meet him. Good defense. Manisto's shot goes wide left to Barczewski. Shouty recovers the rebound, but it's poked away to Seamus Casey, and Stephen Holtz behind the net. Holtz nearly turns it over to Manisto again. Manisto shoves Moldenauer to the ground. Puck works its way back to Manisto, now skating along the left wing. Checked by Nasr, he loses it. Moldenauer had it for a moment. He was checked by Kelly. Kelly, a shot off Barczewski. He can't keep it, and it stays with the Spartans off the rebound. Shouty in the corner. Kelly behind the net. Kelly into Manisto. A shot blocked by Barczewski. Stays with the Spartans. Michigan has to clear. Kelly still got it again. Another slap shot by Manisto. A save. It's Jacob Barczewski. Incredible.
Jake Barczewski needs to cover the puck when he can. That whole drive started with one bad rebound. Cover the puck, earn the whistle.
MSU crowd into it. The puck was cleared. Michigan gets a full change. Ernesty checks Levshin off. Shisky nearly comes away with it in the corner. Michigan State and Nienhaus. Nienhaus, a pass up to Mueller, gets away. Lebster are chased forward in the corner with Warren. From behind the net now, Edwards there as well with Warren. Mueller coming in. Mueller nearly comes away with it. Lebster's got it. Nobody marking him for Michigan. Shifsky comes out. His shot deflected by Edwards. Out in front still. Barczewski's got to get on it, and he does. Jeremy Davidson was in there. Had a chance for the redirect. 12:13 to go in the first overtime frame. Still 4-4. Jake Barczewski. Little things sometimes not there, but he's making the saves when they count. Michigan State up to 34 shots. 34 shots for Michigan. 4-4. The crowd is on their feet at Munn Ice Arena.
Michigan needs to break the puck out. This game is on the line. The Wolverines need to get it out of their zone.
TJ Hughes wins the faceoff for the Wolverines. Casey tries to control it. Comes away with Howard, and Howard tries a pass into the slot. Truscott able to lift it out of the zone for Michigan. Everyone's still on their feet at Munn. Here comes Daniel Russell, a pass into Dorwart. They're called for offsides. And everybody takes a breath and takes a seat.
What a three-minute break we've had here. Michigan State firing on all cylinders. The Wolverine defense unable to break the puck out. We've talked about sustained possession. Spartans finding every rebound. Barczewski needs to cover the puck whenever possible. The Wolverines need to find control.
Michigan dominant on the faceoff in the closing moments of this game, up to 43 wins to the Spartans 31. Warren's got it up to LaPointe. The problem is Michigan hasn't been able to manufacture shots on goal, even with the possession that they've kept. Barczewski plays it out to Warren, and Warren sends it all the way back down to the Spartan end for an icing. 11:30 to go in the first overtime period. And the puck will come back down for a faceoff in the Michigan zone. Crowd back up on their feet. Second line out there for the Spartans. Savage, O'Connell, Larson. Deep pairing is Basgill and Geary. For the Wolverines, it's Warren, Estapa, Edwards, Draper, and LaPointe. Timeout, Michigan.
A good timeout. This is a little stupid, but to give a sense of the energy right now, I've now gotten three hearing damage warnings from my watch. It's too loud in this environment.
And I told you when we were coming in, this place is going to get loud tonight. These fans have wanted great hockey for a while, and they've finally gotten it back.
I think we've seen
nothing but great hockey. Of course, when it's all said and done, there will be things we'll nitpick that could have been done better, could have broken this one out, could have covered that puck. We've seen excellent hockey all game. Jake Barczewski standing on his head as he has at the biggest moments of his career. Michigan and Michigan State.
This is why Barczewski transferred to Michigan, all the way from small school Canisius. The grad student, the NCAA active leader in saves. You may have your thoughts about him, but Michigan's got him now in this situation, a faceoff in their end, 4-4 tie, 30 saves for DJ Barzo. Red Savage and Nasr to face it off. Crowd still on their feet at Munn. Capacity, standing room only crowd. Have to think for the first time in 15 years. Warren falls down, Larson there as well. Red Savage has it for MSU from the corner. Savage dives in, knocked away by Warren and Nasr. To Earnesy, fast break Dylan Dukey, dumps it deep across the red line. Augustine comes out to play it. Into the corner, Nasr there for the Wolverines. Up to the blue line, controlled. Tyler Duke's got it, skating in on the left side, bothered by Savage. Reach the backside boards, right side Holtz. Left side, Dylan Duke rips a shot, goes wide and out of play.
So Michigan takes the opportunity of the timeout to calm down, find the breakout, and establish some possession. It's grown a little bit quieter, still heavy energy here in Munn, but Michigan settled down, managed to move the puck down into the Spartan zone, and even got a few shots off.
Shifsky to take the faceoff against Shouty in the MSUN. He loses it. Here comes the Spartans. Levshinov, cross-ice pass to Manisto, gets away. Shouty there to meet Truscott in the corner. Manisto tries to slot pass to Kelly. Kelly can't gather it and get a shot off in time for Shifsky to reach him. And McGroarty comes over to knock it away.
Kelly was wide open in front. Michigan's been leaving men in the slot open. They need to pick these guys up.
Manisto there for MSU there. The pass can't be completed. Truscott along the boards to Brindley. Passes it up ice. It's picked up by Nienhaus. Manisto flips one up. Gets a change. Kelly's still out there for MSU. Casey for Michigan. A wild pass up to McGroarty. Can't get to him. But it's no icing as it went off McGroarty's stick. Rutger nearly controlled it for Michigan in the MSU zone. Brindley had it for a moment, and it comes back out to Josh Earnesy. Now Brindley, excuse me, it was Tyler Duke. Brindley, right side to Holtz, behind the net McGroarty, back to Holtz, and Brindley can't keep it in. Tyler Duke retreats out to the neutral zone and dumps deep for a Michigan change. In front of the net, it bounced. Augustine had come out to play it, intercepted in the neutral zone by Holtz off the rebound. Holtz sends it around the boards, a stopper there to meet Mueller. Jeremy Davidson has it for the Spartans. 9:34 to go in the overtime period. We will play on until a goal is scored, but we'll have intermissions if this game, or if this overtime frame goes the full 20 minutes.
I think the people want to hear us sing again, William.
I'm not sure about that. Here comes Lebster into the net. He had Davidson wide open in the low slot. He couldn't get a stick on it. Michigan, another big break. Cross ice pass to Russell. He's got nobody home for a pass. Dorwart was late. Up ice to Nasr. Here he comes. One on two for Frank Nasr. Nobody home. Michigan was going for a change. Here comes Dylan Duke off the bench and is met immediately by Patrick Geary. Dorwart there as well. Back around to Edwards. He controls on the blue line for Michigan. 8:49 to go in overtime. Edwards skates inside. Edwards wrap around into the low slot. Nasr can't get a stick on it. Nearly the same play as MSU sequenced before. Warren loses it. A breakaway chance for Michigan ends up nothing. Comes away to Michigan. Excuse me, Michigan State's breakaway chance. Behind the net, Edwards checked. In front, rebound. Still unable to be controlled by MSU. Comes away to Michigan. Edwards along the point. A shot in front is gloved by Augustine and the crowd on their feet.
A shot through traffic with screens in front. We are seeing top-tier hockey. Both teams will finally get a moment of reprieve as Big Ten Network takes the under 10 media timeout.
Oh, my goodness.
What an excellent first 12 minutes of overtime hockey we've seen. It's gone back and forth. Who do you think is dominating
the flow.
Well, Michigan's dominating possession, but MSU has been able to get quality shots on, and that's been the story of the game. But MSU able to kind of get close to Michigan. There was points where Michigan was ahead by about 10 shots in this game. MSU able to close that gap, get pucks on net, but Barczewski has played admirably with how much the Spartans are feeding him. And Michigan unable to get a quality chance on the other end, but it feels like once they do, that's
it. It all comes down to if they set themselves up the way they did for their earlier goals. Can they set themselves up to find those good shot opportunities, connect with rebounds? Because Michigan State's been doing it. The Spartans haven't had as much possession, but when they have in overtime, they have been pummeling Barczewski with pucks. He gives up a lot of rebounds. He stood on his head, but the rebounds are there. There have been multiple times where the Spartans almost won this game.
Crucial moments here. 8:19 to go in the first overtime frame. Tie game 4-4. Both these teams will play on into the national tournament, but they could certainly use a win here tonight as a big emotional booster wherever they go for NCAA regionals. And, of course, the bragging rights of winning your in-state rivalry on a stage like this. MSU wins the faceoff in their own zone. They come out, a pass off of McGroarty finds its way to Joey Larson. Larson into the corner, checked by Casey, stays with State. Savage loses it to McGroarty. Cross-ice pass to Brindley, has to play it off the boards. Now retreating into the corner, Brindley along to Truscott, who controls for Michigan. Successful zone entry for the Wolverines. Truscott, an errant pass gets away though, and MSU able to come away with it. Brindley in the neutral zone fighting, and Augustine plays it from behind his net, and a rare mistake, I'd say, from the captain, Truscott, to play the puck like that and eliminate an offensive cycling chance for Michigan. Warren, all the way up to TJ Hughes, stops it in the neutral zone, but has to bat it back as it was not played well. Draper intercepts across center ice, and he slips down. He had a chance for a breakaway. Couldn't keep his footing. 7:20 to go in the first overtime frame. Again, we will play on until there's a goal.
Credit to Hughes who jumped over the fallen skater.
Once the 7 minute goes up, we will go to intermission if that is the case. 4-4 tie in the Big Ten Championship. Warren to Edwards on the right side. Edwards along the boards, played by MSU. Back out in front of the net, Cucciardi back to Sturback. Nasr there to meet him. Sturback gets a pass up to Manisto, and Holtz there in the corner to play it for Michigan. Gloved by Mueller. He can't keep possession. Earnesty playing hard, and MSU retreats into the neutral zone. Pass along the boards into the corner. Holtz tries to play it along to Nasr, works its way to Edwards. Dylan Duke on the left side, checked, lifts a puck across the Michigan bench. Jeremy Davidson in the Spartan zone picks it up. 6:20 to go in overtime. Davidson, left side, Lebster. Stops on a dime. Ernesty stays with him. A shot from Geary into the net and scores. MSU wins the Big Ten title. Their first ever in program history.
That's going to be very interesting to watch that play out. We'll have some of the coverage of these final few games, especially the home slate right here on WCBN. We'll shift over to bring William.
How are we doing? William, I don't want this to be too loud.
You sound good.
Okay.
You sound good.
All right. You look
like a real reporter now. We got the broadcast headsets on, but we're going to do a stand-up set right here. Williams,
perfect for it, ready to report. Yeah, I can move around. Well, I guess this isn't good radio. I'm playing for the camera. Kendall is grittying off-screen. How much time do we have left?
23 minutes.
All right. Well,
you know what?
I was talking about the Wings. I've talked enough about the Wings.
A negative attitude about our time. It's an opportunity to host the first ever live and televised WCBN post-game show.
This is basically an 11 o'clock DSR. I don't know. Super Bowl's tomorrow.
Super Bowl is tomorrow.
We have a 49. I do feel like a stand-up comedian. The Super Bowl's tomorrow, folks. Have you heard about this? Do you know about this? The Super Bowl's tomorrow. Kansas City Chiefs, San Francisco 49ers. I was very close to doing something related to my belief in the Kansas City Chiefs winning that game, but I chose not to do that thing.
That thing being
something I don't want to say on air.
Okay. Okay.
Well, I don't care. I almost bet like a lot of money on the Chiefs to win the game.
not as much as probably,
I did
probably
not,
Dave Portnoy I did and Drake
not bet.
Did, though.
I did not bet on the Kansas City Chiefs, which means they will win because, you know, I haven't been running into the greatest luck recently on my sports betting escapades.
But let's go into it really fast. So with a game like this, probably the most popular time for people to bet on sports. What are some of your favorite bets that you didn't take but you might have really wanted to
take? I don't know if I'm the right person to ask this. I think CMC is probably going to win the MVP. Anytime touchdown, Rashee Rice, probably. Kendall's going to switch off.
I'm the last person that should be talking about the Super Bowl.
Yeah. Well, more of a lot of people are betting on the over, which I'm not sure about.
I'm not sure about
that
either.
Both those defenses are
really
fantastic.
Good. Yeah.
Schematically, I mean, I don't want to shift away from betting because it's saturating the market too much. I'll make a stand right now on WCBN. This is what you're used to in Ann Arbor. There's too many gambling advertisements.
It's getting a little overkill. I did agree. Yeah.
Yeah, it's tough. That's why I really liked watching the Nick cast. I might have to watch it for the Super Bowl, hosted by SpongeBob SquarePants and Patrick Starr. No gambling advertisements for the kids, only the newest
Nickelodeon
cartoon that will last one season because it's annoying.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kendall, you're a 49er person.
Yeah. This game is probably actually going to come down to the ground game, despite the fact that both quarterbacks have been talked to. I'm trying to think of a word that's not a curse word. Butt and back? I don't know what I'm saying.
Butt
and back. I went in that.
Well, Isaiah Pacheco's a fantastic runner.
Yeah. So it's going to come down to the run game. Both teams actually struggle with the run game, but I think it's going to come down to Kansas City Chiefs maybe inability to protect the run. The 49ers run defense is bad. Anyone can tell you that, but they're bad on the perimeter.
Well,
the Kansas
Detroit
City Chiefs don't run
half.
On the perimeter. They run up the middle, which is where the 49ers are actually pretty good at covering. On the other side, I think Christian McCaffrey's perfectly built to impact all of the Chiefs' defensive flaws. However, it's Patrick Mahomes, so they're going to lose because it's Brock Purdy. Yeah. I believe in Brock. My best friend goes to Iowa State, so we bond over Brock Purdy, George Kittle touchdowns. But
and you talk about the Cyhawk, Caitlin Clark and Brock Purdy have kind of been a little standoffish.
Yeah.
Weren't they at the ESPYs or something like that?
I don't know.
I heard some storyline about Caitlin Clark and Brock Purdy. But I do want to say, you look at that Detroit game. In the first half, the Lions kind of had anything they wanted on the outside. Mm-hmm. And as a person who had a vested interest in that game beyond sports betting, more of my life and my entire life spent being a Detroit Lions fan, I was not happy to see the Lions go away from that approach in the second half, and I think that contributed big to their blowing of a 17-point lead in the NFC Championship game. But to talk about Mahomes, he's faced two double-digit deficits in the two Super Bowls he's played against the 49ers and the Eagles. Two Super Bowls he's won in the past. Double-digit 10-point deficits that he came back from. I'm not sure he's going to have to face that in this game because that Kansas City defense is fantastic. Steve Spagnuolo, who ended the Patriots' undefeated season in 2007 as the Giants' defensive coordinator, is in his bag once again this season with a bunch of guys. I mean, like, they have talented players. Chris Jones is a superstar. L'Jarius Sneed is one of the best cornerbacks in the NFL. But they've done it by committee. Nick Bolton, I think, has been great at linebacker this year. One Michigan player on that team right now is Mike Dana, an interior defensive lineman. But really, it's been one of those no-name defenses that steps up and without superstars has stolen the season, I think, for Kansas City in a way that Mahomes, you know, gets all the attention, but the defense has really been there.
Yeah, I think back to your point, Kendall, about the run game, I think that's completely right. I think both teams have great receivers. At least the 49ers do. Chiefs have made it work. Both have great tight ends, but at times this season for the 49ers and the Chiefs, when the passing game had not really worked out that well, you really did see the run games start to blow up. And with a guy like Christian McCaffrey, as well as a guy like Isaiah Pacheco, you really do see two talented running backs that have been able to feast when they need to, and then two quarterbacks and Patrick Mahomes, who also can use his legs. Brock Purdy, who had rarely used his legs all year, all of a sudden is starting to make that kind of part of his game
as
well.
Brock Purdy has been a scrambler. I texted my friend about this, who goes to Iowa State and has been an Iowa State fan. He said that Brock Purdy had to learn how to scramble so Brock Purdy wouldn't die.
Yeah.
Because he did not ever have a great offensive line at Iowa State.
So, you know, he's started to be able to use that as well. I think as for the over, for what you were saying, William, I don't know if that's going to be the case, but I think you're going to tell really fast what kind of game this is going to be. Yeah. I can see this game going over 50 points. I can also see this game ending in, like, 20-17. So, you know, with both great defenses and also both offenses who can really light the roof off of the stadium, it's going to be a very interesting matchup. And as for, you know, people who are willing to sports bet, I'd really tread cautiously because you just really don't know which each of these teams can give you in this game tomorrow.
Talk about Brock Purdy. I watched a video by Alex Rollins, who makes fantastic NFL content. Usually the day before big games, he puts out a video. And this week it was on Brock Purdy's ability to withstand the blitz. And as a guy with a smaller frame like Purdy, you wouldn't really expect him to be so stout. But that running ability, like you guys mentioned, as well as his ability to stay calm and collected in the pocket. You know, he's not Joe Montana, but like a smaller frame guy, underrated athletically, makes plays in big moments. Like, he has been that guy for the 49ers this season. Like I said, he is not Joe Montana, but there's a reason he was called Joe Cool. I don't know if Brock Cool fits the same way. But I think that that's a big part in this game. You saw the pocket breaking down against Detroit 2 weeks ago, and Purdy made some plays. And this is a guy, like, I get that he was Mr. Irrelevant and all that, but he was, like, mocked as a first-round pick the year before he came out of Iowa State. He's not completely off the radar to college football fans. It's just very funny that it's ended up this way.
Yeah.
Because I thought he was going to be a top pick, you know, with all the hype. Matt Campbell's had, like, 8 years at Iowa State to get them to a Big 12 championship, and the hype's always been there for him. Like, they're always rumoring that he's going to take different Big Ten jobs or the better jobs around the Midwest, but he stuck around at Iowa State and kind of squandered some talent, if I'm being honest. Breece Hall was there. David Montgomery was there. Mm-hmm. Hakeem Butler, if anyone remembers him, was like a 6'6" wide receiver. And they had some Hunter Deckers was a linebacker turned quarterback last year who got suspended for gambling. I don't know. We'll talk a little bit too much about the Cy-Hawk with this crew right now. Because there was also the Iowa players that got suspended for that, unfortunately for them. I don't know. It's a Super Bowl.
It's a Super Bowl.
It's everyone's talking about it. You don't need to get it from us.
It's just something that I feel like it's talked about for so long, kind of like the college football playoff. It's just probably overanalyzed at this point, which is kind of how it is every single year. And it's also a year where there are two teams that have really blossomed at times and two teams that have really struggled at times this season and have both willed their way to the Super Bowl. One team had to defeat the Detroit Lions, who were red hot at that time, and the Chiefs had to go through pretty much all the top teams in the AFC as well. So these teams have proven they can beat good teams. It's not like we have any surprising teams this year in the Super Bowl. And, you know, with all the outside storylines too, with the Brock Purdy stuff being Mr. Irrelevant and the Travis Kelce stuff with Taylor Swift, I think it's also kind of masked, you know, the talent that both these teams have at times this season. And I think both teams are just really excited to play, and they just need to get through this game because, you know, it's the one day a year that all football fans can really just come together and really enjoy. And then you're going to have draft talk for the next 2.5 months until we have it in Detroit.
Brandon Ayuk sees another ladybug or something, because that's what he said
Ayuk,
why he made that catch.
He is just
I said before the year – I've had Brandon Ayuk in every year of fantasy football. I only play in one fantasy league. I said before the year that I would get, like, a signed jersey of his if he won me the league. He didn't win me the league, and he actually cost me the game against the Lions. So Brandon Ayuk – not looking forward to anything special from him in this game. Me personally, that's not what I want. Anyways, we're still on 88.3 WCBN FM Ann Arbor.
I was going to close out my Super Bowl thoughts.
Well, for the YouTube crowd, producer extraordinaire Owen Crain has put in a special countdown clock before we are released from Little Caesars Arena. It's about 10 minutes to go. You just have to talk. You could get Super Bowl content from anywhere
else.
But why wouldn't you want to get it from three people who desperately don't want to be doing it?
But also at the same time, three people who religiously do watch football and have, you know,
you want, some, I mean, to be talking about it this late at night.
Some stakes, you know, in this game one way or another.
You want a Super Bowl take that no one else wants to talk about? there are two great tight ends in this game, and there are also two great tight end significant others. One is better than the other, and it's Claire Kittle. And I'm saying that now, and I'm a Swiftie. Claire Kittle, beautiful woman. She's so nice. I've met her twice.
Oh,
great person.
When did you meet her?
49ers games.
Oh, really?
Well, and Kyle Juszczyk's wife has been
amazing. Yeah, she's great, too.
Styling out.
Christian McCaffrey's fiance was Miss Universe.
Yes, yes. And she made headlines for not being able to afford the Super Bowl, and they were able to get the box for them as well. So, yeah. That's what I'm saying.
Claire Kittle Nation, we're out here.
A lot of storylines surrounding the Super Bowl this year that really don't pertain to football, but that's just kind of what the Super Bowl is.
We're gonna set. We could all be in frame here. I
Someone
feel
hand me my phone.
Very awkward. I'll get you your phone.
Thank you.
I still feel like a stand up with this microphone switching hands.
Then make a joke. Someone did stand up
off the cuff
in my class and in your club.
yes, he did. We don't need to talk about that too much.
I just wanted to mention that
we could talk about Michigan football if you would like to, and all the kind of the coaching carousel if you want to about that. We could talk about Michigan basketball losing by 20 tonight to Nebraska. That was a fun one that we did not have to watch.
Shout out K-State Tominaga.
That was one that we did not have to watch, and I got saved from my other job having to cover that game tonight.
That would be an unfortunate way to spend the tonight.
That would have been awful. That would have been awful.
But this was a tough loss by Michigan. I don't know.
I feel like we're hosting like the New Year's party on CNN or something right now.
Who's Anderson Cooper? Am I Andy Cohen?
Question from the chat.
From Adam Bressler.
What song are we most excited for Usher to perform at the Super Bowl halftime show?
I think is our prop bet Google form submitted by now? Has everyone submitted?
I don't know. I didn't do that.
Well, like, is Lil Jon going to be there?
I don't know.
That's the biggest. But I think his first song will be OMG.
I want OMG. People are like, don't
I want
play OMG.
I want OMG, and I want
Shut
it
up.
First. I think
it's
that'd be a great
song.
It's 2024. Why is Usher at the Super Bowl halftime? Is it 2007? No.
I can't wait for OMG to be played. I can't wait for Yeah to be played, and Lil Jon will be there because it's Lil Jon. He has nothing else better to do.
What will Taylor be doing?
Will Taylor
do the anthem
or
the
halftime? She will be sitting in the box.
Taylor Swift keeps
sitting with Kelsey's
it.
Family.
They keep trying
There's
to get
no
her
No, I know. They've probably offered
After
her
performing.
A lot of money.
In Japan, there is no way. I mean, she's probably on her flight right now coming back. I mean, there's no way she would want to even perform again after doing a full show.
Four nights in Tokyo. She did play Electric Touch as a surprise song. I'm mad about that. I love that song. It's got Fall Out Boy on it. Not like I have tickets, but.
So but have you heard about this? Do you know about this? Usher. The Super Bowl athlete. What is it, 2007, folks? Seriously, why are there so many of these older musicians and actors still
because new people don't want to.
I think my point on this is you're looking at football fans and their demographic, and you're not trying to perform for teenage men and women. You're performing for the older-ish crowd. And I think someone like Usher, and even in the past with even like The Weeknd, you saw Lady Gaga perform. Like, these kind of performers have songs from the past, but also now from the present and maybe even the future. And I think they're the ones that are able to put together a full soundtrack, a full playlist for a Super Bowl, which you're trying to make 40-year-old men really happy. And Usher, I think, is one of those people that could definitely do that.
Why?
I think they're trying to get people who have songs that are just like insanely played. Like, they want you to know every song that the person plays.
And you do.
Because otherwise it's boring.
It's,
like, if you don't know.
Them,
like, when they did Shakira and, like, J-Lo, like, I didn't know all of them, I don't think.
I think it's kind of like SNL.
I think,
like,
they just want you to know their, like, they want you to be able to go, oh, I know that one. Oh, I recognize that one.
Yes.
I know, like,
yes.
And
yes,
it's
definitely.
All, like, radio playing.
Definitely.
Usher dominated
Usher
the early 2000s.
Definitely,
and, like,
definitely.
I mean, late 2000s, early 2010s.
We're still soliciting comments from the chat. We've got 7 minutes left.
I can moderate. Kellen wants to hear about the Pistons.
No.
Adam says Eminem performed 2 years ago, and halftime performers are always old because they have wide audiences.
True.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, Pistons. I talked about them on the broadcast. They look better. They dropped the game against the Clippers. Two-game winning streak before that after cutting some dead weight, including Killian Hayes. Simon Fontecchio, 20 points today in his Piston debut in the loss to the Clippers. I don't know. Like, to have a 28-game losing streak and then maybe not finish as the worst team in the NBA is a huge deal. I still don't want Troy Weaver making any more moves, but things are looking a little bit better. And the one thing I will say, the moves weren't about, I think, addition or subtraction. They were just about empowering the existing players on the team. And I think you saw that two nights ago on the second game of the back-to-back. Jalen Duren had like 27 and 22. Need to get like Wiseman off the whatever, you know.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you, William, what did you think of that trade, and what do you think the plans are going forward after a move that was just made to the Knicks?
They keep talking like they're going to sign some big free agent, but I love Detroit. I'm from the Detroit area. Nobody wants to come to Detroit, especially on like the worst team in the NBA. You know, you just have to overpay them, and then it'll be Ben Gordon, Charlie V all over again, blowing all your cap space. And again, like, Troy Weaver has not done well enough in free agency, I think, to warrant another shot at it. This is his fourth year, and he has yet to surpass, I think, 25. He has not surpassed 30 for sure. I'm not sure if he's gotten to 25 wins in a season. Like, this team has been bad, and it stinks. The Pistons are one of, like, a handful of teams. I'm pretty sure it's under 10 to have multiple NBA titles, three of them. And, like, this team is being run like we're the Charlotte Hornets or the Washington Wizards.
Hey. Yeah, I agree, though.
I mean, those are like the two worst teams in the NBA.
Definitely.
Wizards have not had a 50-win season since 1979.
That's why we're
Adam
Knicks
Bressler.
Fans. That's why we're Knicks fans now.
Yeah. No, I don't ever need to watch the Pistons the rest of the year unless they, I don't know, get like.
Well, then I'll ask you this question. What do you think about the coaching situation? Because I know Monty Williams has kind of been dealt an unfair hand, but he did lead a 28-game losing streak.
I mean,
what do you think about his performance this year, and do you think he does deserve another year or even two after this one?
From everything that I've heard, Owen, please hustle on the graphic. We need it. From everything that I've heard about Monty Williams, like, the rotations have not been very – there have been things that he could have done better – he could have done better to mitigate how bad the losing streak was. And it didn't help that Tom Gores gave him like a blank check coming into town. I'm not sure that he's the kind of coach this team needed. He's like a winning coach, and this team needed a developmental coach still. The NBA coaching cycles are different to where, like, for a contender, you might have two or three coaches, and each of them serve a different role along the way. I'm not sure that Monty Williams was right for this role right now, mentoring young players, especially with the ways he treated Jaden Ivey and how many minutes he gave to Killian Hayes. Like, there were posts on Instagram by Ivy and Duren. Nice one, Owen. We're still here, though. About how broadcaster cam goes down. About how they were – well, it was like veiled criticism of being with Killian Hayes, and they were happier that he was gone. That's not what they said, but that's what you could infer based on what they posted on Instagram. So I don't know. The team's looking better. How much time do we have left? We should probably close this out with something not about the Detroit Pistons. 3 minutes and 20 seconds left. I still want to go to Lafayette Coney Island. Get a Coney dog. I'm not going to lie. But I'm not going to go
they
alone.
They have turned the Jumbotron off.
Yeah, we're here late.
We're here late
in LCA
pretty soon.
We got here early,
sorry, guys, we are here late. Sorry, guys.
This is not their building. This is the Red Wings building. Everything is red. They had to change the seats black because the Pistons couldn't sell tickets to games. They used to be all red. All these seats. Pick up the camera.
Oh, yeah. I thought they were – I feel like they were red
all
last
these
time
seats
I was here.
Were red, and now they're black because the Pistons could not sell tickets to games.
There's the shutoff video board.
And that's the shutoff video board that Owen cares so much about.
I've never seen one turned off.
Well, it's kind of just a big, you know, series of black LED screens.
I'm shocked.
You see it a lot at Chrysler.
I was just saying, I've never seen it.
We have been here too long.
We have been here. We were here 3 hours before the game.
I got here at 5 o'clock.
Yeah, yeah.
We got here at 5:30. It's going to be 11:30 before we even find. What's your favorite video board?
The hospitality at LCA has been good. I mean, like,
good.
They put us in this
we
booth.
We got surprised Little Caesars Pizza for our
meal. That was good.
Tonight.
I mean, Little Caesars Pizza, when it's hot
this
and
was
ready.
The second time I've had it in my
pretty
life.
Pretty good.
Ever.
I think it's
really?
Debatable.
The first was sixth grade.
I've had it many
play
more
practice,
times than
that. And I didn't really like it, so I never got it again.
I am a bit upset. I've had.
We have a viewer question. People are interested. Final. We got about 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Thoughts on Juwan?
Thoughts on Joe? I don't even have a loud speaker.
Well, yeah, no. So let's keep it short. But like, not only has he not conducted himself in a way becoming of the head basketball coach of the University of Michigan, he also has not won games becoming of the head coach of the University of Michigan men's basketball team.
All I'll say is that they're like such a bad second half team that you have to wonder what's being said in that locker room. That is the worst motivational speech of all time.
Yeah.
There's nothing like
that. Well, it's like the last 5 minutes somehow he gives a speech.
Whatever's going on, it's the worst motivation of all time.
How much time we at?
There's confidence issues with the team.
Minute left.
And you know, it's something where we're not gonna speculate on his job in the future. I think for right now, you know, I like him as a person. I like Juwan as a Michigan man. He didn't do a great job of building the team in the offseason to prepare for Big Ten play, and it's biting him right now. And he has three great recruits coming in next year. He's done great in the transfer portal when he's had time to understand what his players are doing. And unlike the last three seasons, he's not expecting three guys to go to the draft and be in a lottery. So you are expecting a lot of these guys to come back next year, and I think if you do retain him, it will be better. It's just obviously – I know everyone's really upset about Michigan basketball right now, as we are, and it's just going to kind of be something that we'll have to figure out in the offseason. As Ward Manuel said, he's not making any decisions right now in the middle of the season.
Okay. Go Niners.
Yeah, so we got to sign off of 88.3 WCBN FM Ann Arbor. Thank you for listening. This has been a 2-3 loss at the hands of the Michigan State Spartans in the Duel in the D. Thank you all for tuning in. Good night, and go blue to our FM audience. And to YouTube, I don't know. The clock has hit zero, and we're still here.
There's
a Saturday Night Live sketch where they're trying to announce the Nickelodeon Kids Choice Awards, and the clock ticks down to zero, and they're going like, the awards are starting right now. It's Ariana Grande in the sketch. It's pretty funny. You should check it out. That's reminding me of this situation, and eventually the clock just started increasing. But for all of us, Jake Singer, Kendall Spencer, Owen Crain, I've been William Gregory. An unfortunate loss at the hands of Michigan State. Michigan fails to pick up a point this weekend against the Spartans and loses 3 out of 4 in the regular season to Michigan State. Next week, Penn State will not be on WCBN. The week after that, Notre Dame. I'll have that game on Friday, February 23rd. Thank you all for tuning in and watching our impromptu live show at the end of this game. We're going to get out of here. Good night and go blue.